2000 meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Board of Appeals. Let the record reflect that all members of the board are present with the exception of Catherine Miller, who advised us in advance that she would be unable to make it because of a conflict. She's in a hearing out of town this evening. The first item on this evening's agenda is the approval of the minutes of the board's meeting of August 22, 2000. Do we have comments from board members on last month's minutes?
On page 4, line 18, Mr. Cronin did not think he qualified under section B that there was no alternative to a variance. I want to say there was a feasible alternative to a variance.
Are you recording? No? Are you recording? Test, test. Yes, we're on. That resolves the technical difficulty portions of the program. Other comments on the minutes?
At page 4, line 13, Van Dyes, and wanted to know if noise, after the word noise, from the proposed workshop should be inserted.
Page 4, line 13, and wanted to know if noise from the workshop.
The proposed workshop.
Okay, and I have...
I'm not sure the tape got Mr. Cronin's comments, so
okay.
You want to repeat it, the secretary.
Mr. Cronin's suggestion was on page 4, line 18, that the sentence read, Mr. Cronin did not think he qualified under section B, comma, that there was a feasible alternative to a variance, rather than no feasible alternative. On page 2, line 29, the minutes referred to the Keating case and the Julian case. The Julian case, the name of it is actually Giuliano, J-U-L-I-A-N-O. And on the same page, line 36, the end of that sentence that starts out with action of the abutters, I think that should read the proposed course of action of the abutters would be to appeal to this board and then to, instead of Supreme Court, it should be Superior Court. A minor item on line 43 of that same page, the sentence says the board's statute should be apostrophe S for board's statute says that any person may appeal, and on my copy it looks like there's a period after appeal that should not be there. On page 3, the second sentence of the paragraph, well, the sentence beginning on line 18 of page 3 is butchered to some extent. I'd like to suggest that lines 17 through 21 simply be deleted. It would be easier than adding the language necessary to make that read correctly, and there's nothing in that comment that is essential to the minutes. But as written, it's kind of nonsensical. So I'd like to suggest that lines 17 through 21 simply be deleted. And those are my only comments. Any others?
Page 4, line 21. The sentence, Mr. LaPlante said that when looking at the site plan, it looked like it was feasible to move it closer. I think my sentiments at the time were it wasn't feasible to move it closer.
Looked like it was not feasible?
It was not feasible in the negative.
Other comments on the minutes? Could I have a motion, please?
Move to accept the minutes as amended.
Second, Mr. LaPlante, all those in favor? Opposed? The minutes are approved by a vote of 6-0. Next item on the agenda, old business. Do we have any old business? I know of none. Hearing none, the next item on the agenda is new business, and the new business on the agenda is to hear the appeal of Ronald and Mary Page, 172 Two Lights Road, tax map U15 lot 05 for a front Beacon Lane property line variance of 7 feet from the required 25 feet to construct a 16-foot by 25-foot two-story addition to the existing dwelling. Do we have people here in support of the Ronald and Mary Page appeal?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, good evening. Members of the board, my name is Michael Traister, and for purposes of the record, I'll spell my name. That's T-R-A-I-S-T-E-R. I'm an attorney with the firm Murray Plum & Murray in Portland, and I represent Ronald and Mary Page, who are residents here in the town, residing at 172 Two Lights Road. Mary Page, Mrs. Page, is here with me this evening. She is this lady sitting here in the second row. Mr. Page, Ronald Page, was unable to attend the proceedings this evening due to the fact that he works at night and therefore was unable to attend. Also, with me this evening is the Page's builder, Zach Davis, who's the gentleman waving to you right now, and he's here and available to answer any specific questions the board may have regarding the actual physical design and construction of the proposed addition that would be undertaken in the event the board were to approve the application before it this evening. Before I begin what I hope is a relatively brief presentation, and I should step back and just state that I'm here really to assist the Pages in answering any legal issues and addressing any legal issues that may arise this evening. Mrs. Page is obviously the interested party here, and she is, of course, available to address the board and answer any board questions the board may have as well. But before I begin, I would like to provide the board with a copy of the town tax map, which was not included with the application, but which I think it would be very helpful to the board in that it gives a good reflection and would help the board understand how the Page's lot is situated with respect to the surrounding neighborhood. And with the chairman's permission, I would like to hand this out to the members of the board.
Thank you. Yes, we'd appreciate that.
Thank you. And as the board can see, we've noted the Page lot, which is indicated as the thin corner lot, seems to be identified as number 5. The application before the board is an application for a practical difficulty variance pursuant to section 19.5.2 of the town's zoning ordinance. And this, of course, is the ordinance or the provision of the town ordinance that the board was discussing with Attorney Wall just earlier this evening. and specifically what the application seeks, as was referenced when the chairman referred to the agenda item, is a 7-foot variance from a 25-foot setback to which the Page lot is subject with respect to Beacon Lane. We believe that those setbacks are set forth in Section 19.4.3A1 of the ordinance, which is at pages 32 and 3 of your ordinance, and it's our understanding that the Code Enforcement Office agrees that those are the applicable setbacks to the Page lot at 172 Two Lights Road. With regard to the Page lot, I think it's very important to note that this lot is very unusual, in fact unique, in that it's subject not only to one front setback, but in fact two front setbacks, because under the town's definition of a front setback, when the lots are situated between two roads, both of those roads are considered to be the front of the property. And that is why we're discussing this evening, not only one front setback, but two front setbacks, particularly the setback applicable to Beacon Lane, which is shown here on the town tax map I provided to the board. As you can see from the town tax map, this lot at 172 Lights Road is in fact unique. It is at most, in fact, 67 feet wide at its widest width. Most of the property, however, is narrower than 67 feet. It's essentially a pie shape, as you can see, wedged between Two Lights Road and Beacon Lane. Extremely unique. We don't believe there's any question about the uniqueness of this lot. Moreover, currently situated on the house is an extremely undersized structure. The current Page home is approximately 927 square feet, which is vastly undersized for the neighborhood in which it is situated. This home has been in existence since, I believe, 1948, and thus has significant historical value which the Pages have striven very hard and continue to strive to maintain. They feel it's very important, and they've undertaken many efforts to preserve the historic character of this house. But that said, this is an extremely small house in comparison to the other homes in the neighborhood, and I'll be providing the board with information which reflects that a little bit later on this evening. This house is also undersized specifically with respect to the home of Daniel and Faye Lakeman, who are sitting here to my left and who we understand will be objecting to the application this evening. It's our understanding, and the fact is, that the Lakeman home is approximately 2,000 square feet, having been expanded after it was purchased by the Lakemans. The existing home, in addition, as reflected on the plans attached to the Page's application, which has been submitted, is 18 feet, currently set back 18 feet from Two Lights Road. And set back on one corner 6 feet from Beacon Lane, only 6 feet, and 3.5 feet from Beacon Lane on the other corner. And again, if you would like to reference the plan, that's reflected on the plans we've given the board. What the Pages are proposing to do, and the reason for the application that's before the board this evening, is to construct what I think can only be characterized as a very modest addition for the purposes of providing a reasonable amount of living space for their family. The Pages have two young children, in addition to themselves, who are residing at the home. And what they're proposing to construct is a 16 by 25 square foot addition, which would allow them to have a living room on the first floor and a bedroom and potentially a bathroom on the second floor. That obviously equates to 400 additional square feet, which would result in a total square footage of just over 1,300 square feet. Still very small by any standard, yet that is what is being proposed by the Pages in an effort to go the extra mile and to minimize whatever impact this addition may have on any of their neighbors, including the Lakemans. The addition is to be situated on what I believe is the west side of the property. As you look at the property from Two Lights Road, that would be the side of the Pages lot to the left, going away from the lighthouse and the lobster shack. And it's been specifically would be constructed on the west side so as to not interfere with what the Lakemans in the past have alleged to be their views on the east side of the Pages house down to the water. And so we specifically are trying to address that concern by constructing the addition to the west. And in that regard, the addition will be no higher than the current height of the existing home, approximately 25 feet, and well within the standard established by the zoning ordinance. As reflected on the plans, the addition that is being proposed will be situated 26 feet from Two Lights Road. That is outside of the 25-foot setback applicable to that side of the Pages property, and therefore no variance is required with respect to Two Lights Road. And in fact, the addition will be 8 feet further back from Two Lights Road than the existing house is situated. The existing house is 18 feet. The addition would be 26 feet back from Two Lights Road. With respect to the Beacon Lane side of the property, the addition, if approved, will be 18 feet from Beacon Lane, which would be 12 to 15 feet further back from Beacon Lane than the existing home is. However, because of the unusual nature of the property, situated between two roads with two applicable front setbacks, that will require, and does in fact require, a 7-foot variance, which of course is why we are here this evening. As I referred to, or may have referred to earlier, the Pages were in fact before the board last summer. I recognize a couple of the members of the board here this evening who are members of the past board, and all of the neighbors at that time strongly supported the Pages variance request with the exception of Daniel and Faye Lakeman. At the time, the objection that was offered to the board was that the proposed addition would interfere with their views on the east side of the home. Again, we're trying to address that concern this evening by ensuring that the construction would occur on the west side, which we do not believe would interfere with any views the Lakemans assert to have with respect to the ocean. The last go-around last summer, the project was in fact redesigned several times to accommodate the Lakemans and to try to minimize any impacts that the construction would have on their properties and their alleged views. Regardless of those attempts, the board ultimately split 3-3 last summer under the old or the different undue hardship variant standard, and finding three of the board members found that the Pages did not meet the criteria which required that the property would not provide them with substantial beneficial use, given that there was already a small home dilapidated at the time on the property. However, I think it's noteworthy that several members of the board did articulate, as I recall, that they had wished that the standard which is now in effect and applicable to this project, that being the practical difficulty variance, would have been in effect last summer. Regardless, as we stand here today, I just want to note that we do not, we meaning the Pages nor I, do not have an understanding of what the Pages, the Lakeman's objection to this project is. The Pages have tried very, very hard to accommodate the Lakemans. We have pulled the house back, as I said, 12 to 15 feet further from Beacon Lane, which is the side of the property the Lakemans' house is on, than the existing home. We are proposing that the house be on the west side of the property, which is not within the claim view shed as we understand it, and it's also going to be no higher than the existing home. Discussions between the Pages and the Lakemans and myself and Attorney Lori, who represents the Lakemans, have led, frankly, to no understanding on the applicant's part as to what the objection is. And we don't believe there would be any harm to the Lakemans as a result of this project, and as a result, we do not believe the Lakemans, in fact, have legal standing to object to this application, given that there is no harm to them. But regardless of the Lakemans' objection, really what this board needs to determine is whether this application and the project being proposed by my client, the Pages, meets the standard set forth by the ordinance, that being the practical difficulty variance standards. And we think that this application clearly meets the standard and meets every element required for this board to give approval to the variance appeal that's before it this evening. In fact, we believe that it's as though the statute was written specifically with this situation in mind. This is the exact situation we believe that the ordinance is designed to address. You have an undersized lot, narrow, no more than 67 feet wide, oddly situated between two roads, in an undersized dwelling vastly undersized in relation to the other homes in the neighborhood. Now, as you were discussing with Attorney Wall earlier this evening, there are certain criteria which the applicant understands it must meet and must satisfy the board have been met before this board will grant approval of the application. The town has adopted a practical variance ordinance pursuant to 30 AMRSA 4353, subsection 4C, which grants municipalities the authority to do that, and the town of Cape Elizabeth's ordinance essentially tracks verbatim the state statute with a minor exception referencing the definition of dimensional standards. In order to meet the test, we understand that we must convince the board that there is no substantial deviation from the intent of the ordinance. And I believe, as frankly as Attorney Wall was indicating a few moments ago, that that is really a catch-all to deal with extreme situations largely involving use deviations with respect to use. We will have no deviation with respect to use in this case. The Pages property is situated within the RA zone. The Pages are proposing to simply construct a modest addition to their home to be used for residential purposes that is clearly permitted, and therefore we believe we meet that element of the variance ordinance. In addition, we believe that we have practical difficulty here as defined by the town's ordinance. Again, as has been discussed, the only real additional element that significant economic, that practical difficulty imposes, aside from the six criteria set forth in your ordinance at section 19.5.2, is that the applicant demonstrates significant economic injury. And that is a concept which the town ordinance specifically defines. And it specifically defines significant economic injury as occurring when the applicant is placed for a variance, and I'm reading from your ordinance at page 16, at a disadvantage in the neighborhood by applying the zoning ordinance standards, which would prevent the applicant from having a structure or accessory structure comparable in size, location, and number to those of other lot owners in the immediate neighborhood, but in no case fewer than 10 of the nearest property owners. As is indicated on the plans attached to our application, and as I've stated this evening, the Page's current home is only 927 square feet. That is extremely small by any rational measure. By contrast, the other homes in the neighborhood are not of that size. And we have, in fact, brought information to present to the board which we believe establishes that. Bruce, has board been provided with this information?
No.
What I have with me this evening are copies of the building records, town public records, for homes in the Beacon Lane neighborhood, showing the square footage, and also with attached to them photographs taken by Mary Page, which clearly evidence that the other homes in the neighborhood are substantially and significantly larger than 927 square feet. And I'd like to, with the chairman's permission, submit these to the record.
Please do.
And I'd also like to note, if I'm not mistaken, that Attorney Laurie has been provided with this material prior to this evening. Is that correct?
I believe they're the same. I haven't seen these, but I believe they're the same. Just one
copy. Mm-hmm. So again, we believe that we can and do demonstrate significant economic injury as defined by the town's ordinance. And indeed, it would seem as though the ordinance were drafted with this specific situation in mind. But in addition to showing significant economic injury, perhaps I should give the board a moment to review that material.
Mr. Treister, do we have anything that indicates where these properties are?
I believe Mrs. Page noted on the bottom of each building record the address. Is that correct? On the top of each building record. I would also mention that I believe that under the Maine Supreme Court case law, which is not directly applicable to the practical difficulty standard because it's so new, that this board does have the authority as a general matter to employ its own knowledge as members of the community to the neighborhood and conclude, irrespective of the information just provided, that the Page home is in fact undersized with respect to the surrounding neighborhood, and therefore the Pages would in fact incur significant economic injury as a result of the application of the ordinance in the absence of a variance.
I'm looking at these photos, and I'm trying to identify them with the assessor's map. I see street addresses. Is there any reference to these tax maps or tax cards that would identify the... I mean, these things look bigger than the lot that we're talking about.
I have a list of abutters here with the map and lots. If you...
168 Two Lights Road.
168 Two Lights. That's U1567.
67.
Across the street.
I think 168 is the lot immediately west.
Right.
It would have been helpful if they were identified with the tax record, just so that we could see the size of the lot, compare the size of the lot and what you're dealing with, just as a comment.
To the Page's defense on that, if I may say, because this wasn't part of the application, but only because we knew that the board may require that, I asked the Page's to submit. Certainly, we're going to include it in the application. We'll hopefully get a little bit better as we go with other applications.
Well, I just think it's incomplete evidence, and it would have been a lot more helpful if we had that reference. And I'll just show you this particular house. I mean, there's a lot of...
You want... Just got all the tax...
Well, I don't want to take time out of the hearing, but I'll just...
The board can certainly table the matter if that's a choice. I asking the Pages to do this, it was only asking because it wasn't part of the application, but I knew it was an issue with the board based on Mike Hill's letter.
I guess two lights, ten.
Board conducted a site view prior to hearings.
Joe, could you pass those packets to them?
We will keep these as part of the record?
Yes, please.
You don't intend to get these back, I assume? I think they should be retained as part of the record of the hearing.
Well, once it's submitted, they really have to.
That's a good point.
Go ahead, Mr. Traister.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Based on that information as well, again, I just want to reiterate that I believe the board has the discretion and the authority to employ its own knowledge as residents of the community of the Beacon Lane neighborhood to conclude that the Page's current home is undersized. With that, in conjunction with the information we provided, we believe we meet the significant economic injury element that is required for the board to approve the application this evening. In addition, the variance standards require that six conditions be met, and those conditions are set forth at pages 46 to 47 of your ordinance and section 19.5.2 of your ordinance. And we believe we clearly meet all of those conditions. The first condition is that the property is that the need for the variance is due to the unique circumstances of the property and not to the general conditions of the neighborhood. As we've already discussed at some length, the Page's lot, as is clearly reflected by the tax map, which has been submitted as part of the record, is extremely narrow, vastly narrower than any other lot in that neighborhood. It's at most 67 feet wide. It is subject to two 25-foot setbacks. And as I think is must be eminently obvious, is simply unique in comparison to every other lot in that neighborhood. The second condition that must be met is that the granting of the variance will not produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood and will not unreasonably detrimentally affect the use or market value of abutting properties. That standard is also met in this case. As I've indicated and as is set forth on the plans attached to the application, the addition will in fact be 12 to 15 feet further back from the Page's existing home. There will be no significant impact on the neighborhood whatsoever. In fact, approval of this project and construction of this modest addition will do nothing more than enhance the property values of all the abutters and the neighbors surrounding the Pages, because we will go from a extremely undersized 927 square foot home to a more reasonable 1,327 square foot home. That will do nothing more than increase everybody's property values on Beacon Lane. The addition is simply to provide additional living space in a residential neighborhood that is entirely consistent with the uses in the neighborhood and the surrounding properties. There will be no impact on any abutters' views. This addition is to be constructed on the west side of the Page's property, on the side not claimed in the past by the Lakemans to constitute their view shed. There's no fire issue here, safety issue here. The addition will not cast a shadow on any neighbor's property. It will certainly not devalue anybody's property by more than 10%. In fact, it will do nothing more, as I've said, but to increase everybody's the values of everyone's properties. And it will not eliminate the privacy of any abutting lot owners. This is simply going to be a modest addition to an existing home on an existing lot. And there are simply no impacts that would rise in any way to an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood. The third criteria that must be met is that the practical difficulty is not the result of action taken by the applicant or a prior owner. The need for this variance is not the result of action taken by the Pages. The lot, as reflected on the tax map, has been in existence at least since 1948, as reflected on the building records. The zoning ordinance was enacted many, many years later, and the only reason we are here this evening is because of the impact of the zoning ordinance. The Pages have not conveyed any portion of their lot or otherwise taken any action with respect to their property, which has given rise to the need for this variance. fourth factor which must be met is that there is no feasible alternative, and that is a concept also defined by the town's ordinance. And I will quote that. In the case of a variance request, there is no other place on the lot taking into consideration the physical constraints of the property or no other location on the structure that the proposed construction could go without the need for a variance or without causing the owner to create other compliance problems on the lot because of the zoning ordinance, deed restrictions, or conditions imposed by a lease or contract. Due to the unique nature of this lot being only at most 67 feet wide, and in fact closer to 60 feet wide throughout the majority of the lot, there is essentially no construction that can occur, reasonable construction that can occur on this property without the need for a variance. But that aside, I think what the appropriate inquiry for this board is to view and to consider the proposal that is actually before it, and that is a 16 by 25 addition. And pages are entitled to have the board consider that proposal and whether it meets the standards. And there is no place or location on the page's lot that this addition could go that would not require a variance, and therefore there is no feasible alternative. The lot is simply too narrow. And then finally, the fifth factor is that there's no impact on the environment. The page's construction of the addition will not involve the cutting of any trees or have any other adverse impact on the environment. No shrubs, no trees, no vegetation. Essentially, other than perhaps grass, will be removed from the property. And the last criteria is that the property not be within the shoreline zone. As we've discussed, this property is not within the shoreline zone, it's within the RA zone. So based on that, all of the criteria, every one of the six conditions required by section 19.5.2 is met in this case. The pages can in fact and do in fact demonstrate practical difficulty as defined in your ordinance. And we believe that the test is met and that the pages are entitled to approval of their variance application. I'd like to again state that we have tried very hard to accommodate the Lakemans. We have relocated this addition to the west side. It has been redesigned since last year on multiple occasions. And again, we don't know what the objection is. We believe there is no harm to the Lakemans from this proposal whatsoever. And with that, we would respectfully request that the board approve the application before it and grant the pages a 7-foot variance from the 25-foot front setback applicable to their property with respect to Beacon Lane. And at this point, I'd be happy to answer any questions that the board may have.
Questions from board members?
With respect to this house, you've designated that area of this house, which is down the street from it, I looked at the property today, is 744 square feet, and then you added in the garage to get your 1,200, or?
Mary, they had recently expanded on that property, and that is the old property card.
Who is that?
16 Beekman Lane.
As you know, in the property,
is that Robert? Is that Robert Hark? Yes, they have recently expanded a second floor, and it doesn't reflect a full second floor, and doesn't reflect on the property card as such.
I'm looking at the picture. The second floor is the same dimensions as the base? Or
I'd have to look.
Yeah. The reason I brought that up is when looking at the adjacent properties today, that struck me as similar in size to the Page's property. Do you have a comment on that? It's not. It's.
I believe it's 1,200 square feet, Mary.
Mr. Yorks.
Doyle.
Yes.
We added 432 square feet.
Ask the owner.
Yeah, the picture reflects what's there now, but the floor area doesn't for some reason. I don't know why, but.
Other questions for Mr. Traister from board members?
I have questions for the builder, if that is permissible at this time.
Sure. Can we bring the builder forward?
I know we only have one applicant this evening, but for sake of moving things along.
And again, would you please state your name and address for us?
Yep. My name is Zach Davis, and I'm currently living in Yarmouth, Maine.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.
Is there any blasting proposed for a foundation?
There is not. There is not any blasting proposed.
There's no blasting?
No.
I noticed in the plan that you have a swing-in doors, atrium doors, on the left side of the plan, looking at it from Two Lights Road. Is it Two Lights Road? Yes, Two Lights Road. Are you proposing to put steps or a deck there?
Possibly one or two steps. It would come fairly level to the ground, so you should be able to step out the door. Right now, the current door, which the elevation is the same, 25 feet away, you do need one step out the door.
One step going out?
Yep.
All right. Is there a variance, Bruce, is there a variance required for steps coming out of this new addition?
I don't consider stairs for ingress, egress as needing to meet the setbacks.
Okay, but a deck or anything more than stairs?
That's correct.
Would be an item that would be
yes.
Requiring a variance. Okay. And I noticed that you're going from two bedrooms to three bedrooms.
Correct.
Do we need an okay on the septic system for that? I know the septic system was
a new septic that was designed for three bedrooms.
Okay, thank you. That's all the questions I have for the builder. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Other questions for Mr. Traister?
One of the criteria look at is views. Have you any evidence from done any studies? Can you introduce anything that establishes that there's no interference with views?
I believe, well, in part, part of the public record now, the proceedings from last year in which the view was alleged to be on the opposite side of the property from where this proposal is. However, I do have a couple of photographs taken from the top of the
hill. Yeah, taken from the peak of the roof to where the addition is going to be added on, where we would like to add it.
Which reflects the view from the top of top of the home to the ocean.
This would be looking towards the ocean?
Yes, it should be written on there.
Right.
And then on the other one, you'd be able to see the top of the Lakeman's house if you look down.
This is the Lakeman's house?
That's the Lakeman's house, yes. From the top of our roof.
And I would like to note that we dispute that there are even views on the east side of the Page's property from the Lakeman home. Theoretically, do you put this? Is there any limitation that you see that would not allow Pages to build up to 25% of that lot? I'm trying to get your theory of the variance. We know it's a small lot, and the question is, how big a house was theoretically possible from your point of view? Well, we're proposing a total structure that would be approximately 10% of the land mass. The lot is 13,115 square feet. With the addition, it would be approximately 1,327 square feet. I'm not sure I'm understanding your question.
Well, okay. One of the issues that is come up with me is that if you have a house on a 1 acre set lot, mm-hmm. And are you measuring the adjacent neighborhood? So you look at that, the size of that house, say it's 2,000 square feet on a 1 acre lot, and does it therefore that on a 13,000 square foot, which is what, a third of an acre lot, it's entitled to the same size house?
I believe that the town protects itself through its maximum building coverage requirement. The definition which we, I believe, need to meet is set forth in the definitional section of significant economic injury, which specifically states, and this is the ordinance that the town has passed, that the applicant would be placing the applicant for a variance at a disadvantage in the neighborhood by applying the zoning ordinance standards, which would prevent the applicant from having a structure of comparable size. And that's the evidence we've submitted this evening. That would only be approximately, if approved, a total building coverage of approximately 10%. I believe this is an on-site sewage system, Mary, that the standard we have to meet is 20%. We're at most halfway there.
Other questions?
Could you restate the variance request that you referred to from last year?
The variance request last year, there was an alternate design, a different addition was contemplated, and that was submitted last summer under the undue hardship standard. As I recall, I don't have those plans from last year in front of me, but as I recall, what was proposed ultimately after redesigning it several times in an attempt to accommodate the Lakemans was an addition which would be on both sides but lower than the existing home. One addition going off the east side, a small addition going off the left side, but significantly lower than the existing home, which is perhaps Mr. Davis can answer. This is existing home, approximately 25. Mr. Davis, in fact, designed that addition as well. He might be better able to answer your question.
I believe the final design involved a single level addition on each end, and now we've moved basically one level over, so now it's two stories on one side that's being proposed this evening.
And what was the outcome of that?
There were six members of the board present. It was a split 3-3. Four votes were required, and it was therefore denied on the basis that we didn't meet the subset of the substandard, which required a showing of no beneficial use of the property, which of course is not the standard which we're governed by this evening.
The existing house now is roughly 30 and a half square, is that correct?
Correct.
So the 927 square feet you refer to as footprint, land footprint. That's not the gross living space, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Currently, the configuration of the house, is there two bedrooms and one bath? Is this correct?
I believe that is correct.
One and a half? Okay. And you're proposing a second bath upstairs? I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Come to the microphone, please.
Yes, on this proposal, it's for a bath, a master bedroom with a master bath.
And on your drawing, page 8 of 8, it does not show the bath?
I do not believe it reflects that now. No, due to circumstances, we don't know if we can afford to put a bathroom up there.
I'm sorry?
We don't know if we can afford to put a bathroom upstairs now.
But
it would just be a master bedroom, a 16 by 25 master bedroom.
Right now, there are two bedrooms upstairs.
Right.
And no bath upstairs.
There's a water closet, a toilet, and a sink, yes.
And in your proposal, if you did add another bath, would it fit in this existing proposal space?
Yes, it would. Yes, it would. It would be a master bath. Yes.
It would, so it would be in the added bedroom upstairs on the addition? Would be in that location?
Yes, it would be.
That wouldn't require any additional enlargement to accommodate the bath?
No, it would not.
And before you leave the microphones, for our record, you are Mary Page,
I am
correct?
Mary Page, yes.
Of 172 Two Lights Road?
172 Two Lights Road, Cape Elizabeth, Maine.
Thank you, Mrs. Page.
Also, before you leave, could I get a clarification? The footprint is 30 by 30, is that correct?
Yes.
And this is a two-story building?
Yes.
So we're looking at approximately 1,800 square feet of living space now?
Now?
30 by 30 is 900.
Second floor has knee walls.
Has knee walls, so what are we looking at?
Knee walls 4 feet in?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know any walls?
Your first floor is 30 by 30. Your second floor is 16 by 30.
Right. 16 by 30?
Mm-hmm. There's basically a lean-to section on each side of the house. So that's 480 on top of the 900. So you're looking at 1380 total square footage current, 900 square foot of footprint.
Okay, fine, thank you.
The proposed addition 16 by 25, which is 400 footprint, 800 total square foot increase.
Thank you.
So when we're done with the addition, the total living area will be roughly 2,180 square feet. Does that sound correct?
That is approximately correct.
Well, Mr. Chapman, thank you, and Mr. Frustasi for clarifying that, because I was under the impression that the total square footage after the addition was going to be roughly 1,300 square feet.
And I believe I may have stated that, and I apologize to the board. I was unaware of the second floor calculation that needed to be added. I should have referred to the footprint, not the living space.
Mr. Chapman.
On your application for a building permit, page 2, midway down, number of additional bedrooms, 3. Is that a typographical error?
When that application was filled out, Mrs. Page understood that to mean total bedrooms. In fact, she's just adding, proposed to add 1 bedroom for 3 total bedrooms, not 3 additional bedrooms.
That should correctly read then that line, number of existing bedrooms, 2, number of additional bedrooms, 1.
That is correct.
Okay. And Bruce, this design flow for the septic is appropriate for 3 bathroom. Or 3-bedroom house.
Yeah, the code says 90 gallons a day per bedroom, so for a total of 270. This is designed at 305, so it has a little bit of a cushion.
Other questions?
You want to comment then on, again, it's the one house I thought was comparable in size, which I now find is comparable in size, that it had, Sheltman said it was 432-foot addition, so that's 744 plus 432, that's 1176, right? Which is down the street, right? Do you have any comment on that?
My only comment would be we have to look at all the homes in the neighborhood, not just one isolated home, and that is what the proper comparison is to.
Mr. Tracer, anything else that you would like to present at this point?
No, other than to note that it's my understanding that several of the neighbors have submitted letters to the board in support of the Page's application. I'd just like to ensure that those are read or otherwise introduced into the record?
Well, for the record, the only letter that I have in my packet is a letter dated September 18 from Peter Barr at 20 Beacon Lane, who says, "My wife and I have no objection to the proposed addition." It goes on to say more than that, but that's the essence of their letter.
Okay.
That's the only letter that I have. Do other board members have the Peter Barr letter?
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's the only one that was submitted for the record.
Is there another, are there one or more letters that you expect us to have?
Apparently there is only one letter, but I do know that there are other neighbors here to speak in support of the application.
Okay. Well, if there are you finished at this point with
yes,
your presentation?
I am, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others here who would like to speak in favor of the application?
Yes.
Please come forward. And if you would state your name and address for us, please.
Yes, my name is Bruce Munger, and my address is 175 Two Lights Road. Directly across from the pages. And I would like to emphasize that the house is rather undersized for the neighborhood. Our house is 2,200 square foot. Granted, we are on an acre of land, but I would offer up that in that neighborhood there are houses on much smaller than a third of an acre that cover much more than 2,200 square feet of living space. I don't think that's a valid question. But as far as the neighborhood is concerned, there is nothing but improvement that would come from putting an addition to this house. When we built there 6 years ago, again, when the house was owned by Mrs. Clark, it was an eyesore. But in anticipation that at some point that house would be fixed up, I'm very pleased with the fact that they've kept the character and the charm of that house. And with the addition, I'm sure that there will be no detriment to that property or to the surrounding properties. Just, I'm sure that you're aware of, in the short term, in the last year, there have been additions, new structures going on around that are far larger than that structure. And it really would be a travesty not to allow them to construct that addition.
Questions from the board members for Mr. Munger? Thank you, Mr. Munger. Anybody else who would like to speak in favor of the application? Yes, ma'am. And if you would be kind enough to tell us your name and address, please.
My name is Jean Munger. I'm married to Bruce Munger, who was just up here a moment ago. I live at 175 Two Lights Road. I'd like to speak to the integrity of the pages. We found them to be exceptional neighbors. We found them to be very concerned with every step along the way, not only with us, but having spoken with numerous neighbors, they have made every effort to take into consideration our needs and our desires. Personally, I don't know why the Lakemans are providing such a barrier. I suspect it might have something to do with a little piece of the property, the Pages property that is adjacent to theirs that's interfering with their putting in a driveway, I suspect. You might want to check that. As far as the ocean views, I question myself. They may well have ocean views very similar to ours, which means that maybe after the leaves fall, our house is, you know, pretty close to that height. After the leaves fall, we'll be able to see a little sparkle here and there of water. Now, they may have more than that, but I don't think it's quite like having an oceanfront property. So I know that the Pages have tried very hard working with their builder. Their builder's very well known. He's very well respected. He took a dilapidated home and just made it into something really beautiful. He kept the integrity of the house. He built quality product. We're delighted that they, that the Pages live there, and that, that they've got the builder that they do. In fact, we've thought of when we, you know, if we do, can't afford that, we would like to engage his services as well. But they've just dealt with such integrity, and I've hated to be neighbors of theirs and had such difficulty for them in anything that they're doing when they're just trying to be such good neighbors. We think that not only their house, but they have been a tremendous addition to the neighborhood, very positive addition. So I just want to go alongside my husband, and also I've spoken to other neighbors, and I believe that, that our sentiments collectively, Bruce and mine taken together, are very reflective of the neighbors, except for the Lakemans. And I do hope that something can be worked out, because I know it's their hope that they do not proceed without taking full consideration of any detriment that could possibly happen.
Questions from board members? Thank you, Ms. Munger.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else to speak in favor of the application? Yes, sir. And your name and address, please.
Gordon York, 16 Beacon Lane. I'm kind of the new kid on the block. We've only been there a little over 2 months. We spent a little time prior to that doing renovations. But previously, when they first made application, my father-in-law was alive. He lived at the property where we now live. And I know that he sent a letter in support. We have not been polled, but we would do so if we were polled in support of their renovation. The house at the head of the street was originally, before Clark, was owned by my father-in-law's father. And we were quite enthused to see how well they had restored it to make it look like the house used to look years ago. It's really looks nice. I just wanted to say that I think they're trying to improve the neighborhood, and it appears that they're doing a good job. I don't see any reason, reasonable reason, now with the change in the law and your new regulations, why they should have a problem. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any questions from the board? Thank you, sir. Anybody else to speak in favor of the ordinance? I mean, in favor of the application. Hearing or seeing no one else to speak in favor, thank you all who did come to speak in favor. I should say, for the benefit of both the applicant and also for the Lakemans who are here to oppose it, although the board always welcomes input from any neighbors or interested people to speak in favor or opposed, that we don't make a decision based on popularity of a position one way or the other, but rather based on whether or not the applicant meets the strict terms of the ordinance. But that having been said, I know that we have at least one party here to speak against the application. So whoever is here to speak against.
May I ask one question first?
Sure, Mr. Chemnitz.
Regarding the remodeling that took place by the Pages that was referred to, was any variance required to undertake that remodeling?
No, it was all within the constraints of the existing footprint.
Thank you.
My name is David Laurie. I'm an attorney. I live in Cape Elizabeth, but I'm an attorney, and I represent Daniel and Faye Lakeman, who are made out to be the bad guys here, and I'll explain in a minute why they're not and why they're here in opposition. Before I get into that, let me go through a couple of things that Mr. Traister said that I think need to be clarified, explained, or contradicted. First of all, there has to be evidence to support any finding that this board makes. Yes, you're allowed to draw on your personal, your knowledge of the area, and but that's not a substitute for evidence. You're supposed to be presented with evidence which supports findings, which you're required to make under the ordinance. So a court can look at it and say, yes, there was substantial evidence. The courts apply what's called the substantial evidence test. It doesn't take much to be substantial evidence. There has to be something there to support any finding that the board makes. You can't make something up out of whole cloth, and you can't substitute for evidence. Yes, you're not disqualified from having personal knowledge of the area. In fact, the courts see that as a benefit, and that's the reason why they don't usually second-guess your decisions. That's why they usually support what the board does. But it's not a substitute for evidence, and there does have to be some evidence in the record with regard to any finding which you're required to make under the ordinance. The second thing, and I really appreciate Mr. Frestacci for finally getting a number as to what the size is of the existing structure on the Page property and what it's going to be afterwards. There are all kinds of numbers there. Some of the plans, in fact, show a bedroom and a living room, 320 square feet, when in fact it obviously has to be 400 square feet because it's 25 by 16. You know, but it says on the plan 320. You see it, you'll see it on the most recent plan as well. And, you know, we think that 2100, an increase from what is, let's see, we finally got to a number. See, it's currently 1380 square feet, I think, is what was agreed to. And the addition would be another 800 square feet. So we're talking about going up to 2180 square feet. So that's what I'm going to direct my comments to as I go through this. There's a lot of talk about the house being undersized compared to the neighborhood and undersized compared to the Lakemans, and then they pointed to the fact that the Lakemans have a 2,000 square foot house. Of course, the Lakemans also have a huge lot by comparison. I mean, this is a incredibly small lot, and even if you didn't, even if it weren't bounded by two streets, it would be a substandard lot in any way you look at it. Yes, the property is unique, but that isn't a reason for allowing a person to come along, buy the property, and then build out to the property lines or to the street lines in all directions, or under, if not to the street lines, under a variance, which is a substantial variance. Let me address one couple more points that Mr. Tracer made before I go through my prepared remarks. He said that they had no understand. Well, first of all, let me deal with Mrs. Munger's statement a moment ago that the Lakemans want Page's land. They don't need any land from the Pages. They have plenty of land. They don't need any. That apparently arose out of a discussion I had with Mr. Traister, in which we tried to initiate discussion of a possible compromise, and Mr. Traister wanted to know what our thoughts were, what the concepts might be, before he went and talked to his clients about my client's request that they be able to talk directly with the Pages. And that's all that they asked me to do. They said they want to talk to the Pages. I related to Mr. Traister, unfortunately, that one possible scenario which would allow the Lakemans to not be here tonight opposing this might be if they could in fact plant some trees. Unfortunately, the place where they have to plant trees is where their current driveway is, which would require them to relocate their driveway. And I made the mistake of relating that to him because the next thing I knew, he called me back with an offer to sell that lot and have us drop our opposition. And I said, that wasn't what I was authorized to discuss with you. I'll relay it to my clients because it's an offer, but anyway, that's the origin of it. My clients don't want that land. And the only reason why the suggestion was ever made that anything be done on that land was in order to accommodate a relocation of the driveway, but that's enough. And I didn't want to get into that, but Mrs. Munger did, and I just wanted to clear the air. There is nothing, they don't want the land. The, as in the last appeal, the Pages went around the neighborhood asking for support of their variance from other property owners, and last time they had quite a bit of support because the place was an eyesore. It had been allowed to deteriorate to the point where the town should have had it taken down as a dangerous structure, should have been taken down. But in fact, it was allowed to stand there in its open and dilapidated state, and the Pages bought it in that condition, and then they came in and asked for variance, which the Lakemans then opposed. And everybody in the neighborhood just wanted to see it fixed up. They just wanted to get past that. And we told the board last year, and we were right, that that property was going to get fixed up regardless of whether you granted the variance or not, that you didn't have to be held hostage with the variance, that in fact it would be fixed up, and it was. The Lakemans heard about this new appeal for the first time when they received the notice of hearing from the town, although apparently the Pages were out getting support from their neighbors again for this without talking to the Lakemans about what their concerns were. And let me get into what their concerns are. The Lakemans purchased their house back 10 years ago. And they're very careful people. They wanted to make sure that they had a nice place to live in, to retire into. They had a large family, which has moved out now, and now they have a small family. It's just the two of them there. They went through, they inquired as to the status of the property now owned by the Pages, and obtained assurances that this house, which is shoehorned onto that property prior to zoning, couldn't be expanded. The Lakemans purchased in reliance on the zoning and the representations of town officials. They talked to Ernie McVane, they talked to the assessor, Jerry Daigle, and they learned that, and they confirmed that no expansion would be permitted. The Lakemans opposed this variance appeal as they did the prior request because they believe the proposed addition will make the small house into one just capable of housing a large family. Now, you heard a little while ago about the mistake that was made with respect to the building permit to add three additional bathrooms. In fact, three additional bedrooms. In fact, if this addition goes through, there will be nothing to stop them from coming back a few years later, and not even coming back here, but just making the change and putting in the required walls, partition walls, and having additional bedrooms there. In fact, you heard from the code enforcement officer that the septic system is sized for additional bedrooms, to accommodate additional bedrooms. And that could certainly happen in the future. There's no assurance that in the future there will not be additional bedrooms put in there. And this house, whether it's owned by the Pages or someone else in the future, will have three bedrooms or four bedrooms or five bedrooms, depending on the will of the person who lives in it. And the Page's attorney has repeatedly demanded to know the specific reasons why the Lakemans oppose this variance. Just because it's not as burdensome as the variance that they asked for last year. Last year, they were on the other side, and they would have blocked the Lakemans' view of the water. But that wasn't the real reason why the Lakemans opposed it last time. They opposed it because they wanted the benefit of their purchase. They very much enjoy spending time in their yard, gardening, and so forth, and they wanted a quiet neighborhood, and they want a reasonable amount of privacy. Dan Lakeman told you last year that if 172 Two Lights Road was enlarged, it would not only form a more extended wall along Beacon Lane in front of the house, but it would also accommodate a larger number of people, create a lot more activity practically in their front yard. Homes accommodating large families on either side of them, and the Lakemans were naturally concerned about having a large family in the lot in front of them when they purchased the property. Their family has grown and moved away from home, and I don't think there's anything wrong with them wanting to secure a little peace and quiet. So the Lakemans did what any prudent buyer would do, they read the zoning ordinance. And when they did so, they found that the only basis for expanding this would be the undue hardship variance, which the pages tried to get last year. And they learned that there was no way that an undue hardship variance could lawfully be granted on this property. They confirmed at the time all of these things. The pages didn't do any of this before they bought the property. They bought the property, and they've been trying ever since to build a large house on this small lot. The Lakemans are asking you to stand by the ordinances of the town, which offer mutual protection and benefit to all property owners. They provide some certainty, whether you're an average American family, a large family, a single householder, a couple, or any other variation of home ownership. Neither I nor the Lakemans have a 320-foot master bedroom, or I guess it's actually a 400-foot master bedroom. And the potential for having, as I said before, the potential for having a fourth or even a fifth bedroom in the future in this house is one which we think the board needs to be aware of, because that can be done without any further action by this board. Now, the town has adopted a practical difficulty standard for dimensional variance, which is what we're here on tonight. As in the case of undue hardship variance, which was denied last year, and I believe you're told this by your attorney in the executive session, in the workshop, the board must follow the new standard strictly and grant variances only where the requirements for dimensional variances are all met. Now, going through those, what we have under the statute and the ordinance is first a two-pronged practical difficulty definition. And this, the two-pronged practical difficulty definition goes beyond what your attorney was talking to you about in the workshop. What we're talking about here is the requirement that to grant a variance from the dimensional standards of the zoning ordinance, the petitioner's property has to suffer from a practical difficulty, and the statutory conditions must exist. Now, the definition of practical difficulty, which is a two-pronged test that I'm talking about now, which is, as I said, different from what your lawyer talked about, as used in this section, practical difficulty means that the strict application of the ordinance to the property precludes the ability of the petitioner to pursue a use permitted in the zoning district in which the property is located and results in significant economic injury to the petitioner. Thus, to meet the statutory definition of practical difficulty, the applicants must demonstrate that they meet both prongs, that the strict application of the ordinance to the property precludes their ability to pursue a use permitted in the district, and the strict application of the ordinance to the property results in significant economic injury to them. The proposed findings that were prepared by the code enforcement officer omitted these requirements, and we applaud the town attorney for instructing you that you do need to make specific findings with regard to practical difficulty, with regard to the significant economic injury. We think that you are also, I submit, and I know for a fact, that the courts will require you to make a specific finding with regard to the use as well. And we read that use provision a little bit differently than you heard it explained to you this evening. That use provision is not just a repetition of the prohibition on uses not permitted in the zone. You can't grant a use variance, and you can't grant a variance for a use which is not permitted in the zone. It says that elsewhere in this ordinance and in other places, actually, in the code. But in fact, the requirement here is something more. It is that the applicant be precluded from a use which is permitted in the zone. That means that they not be able to have it. For example, a use which is allowed here, an accessory use is a garage, let's say. And that came up at the workshop. You've got a garage as allowed as an accessory use, and if you can't put a garage on in a residential property, then you're being precluded from having a lawful accessory use, and you can't have a garage. So therefore, you can qualify for a variance to put in your garage, because that's a permitted accessory use. Here, what we have is an expansion of the principal use, which is residential. That's what they're talking about doing. They already have a residential use on the property. And we think that the statute was not intended to allow dimensional variances to expand expand the principal use, even though it's a lawful use, because that use is not precluded. The preclusion element has to be addressed.
Excuse me, Mr. Horry.
Go on.
Can you go back over that again?
Okay.
If I'm hearing you correctly, it sounds like you're reading the preclusion to be somewhat akin to the undue hardship.
No, because on the undue hardship test, you couldn't have a garage, which would be an accessory use, or some other use which is permitted in the zone, which you're otherwise precluded from having by reason of the setbacks. You've already got a use on the lot, a principal use on the lot. Then that is what you're not allowed to get more of. You're allowed to have other lawful uses. You have to identify a use which you're precluded from having. It says, you know, that's what the statutory language is. It talks about preclusion. And yes, it works out to be the same in some cases, but it doesn't work out to be the same in all cases. You could still allow a garage, for example, as an accessory use. And there are other accessory uses or other uses, other uses which are allowed in the zoning ordinance on any given lot, which you could permit under that interpretation of the statute. And I think that that's the proper reading of it, because variances, although they were intended to be liberalized by this new statute, were not intended to substitute for changes in the zoning ordinance itself. This board should not be, and boards of appeals, should not be substituted for legislative bodies in granting variances regularly. Variances are supposed to be based upon, even under the most liberal standards around the country, variances are exceptions to the rules. You're not supposed to rezone by variance. And to allow everyone to come in, as the pages have, with very small lots, and say, I'm entitled to expand my structure however much I want. And we'll get into the town standards, the comparability standards, in a minute. But that is not what variances are for. Variances are a safety valve to relieve hardship, not necessarily undue hardship now, but some hardship under the ordinance, and not to be a substitute for the whole process of developing and maintaining zoning throughout the town. People like the Lakemans ought to be able to look out and say, I know what the zoning is, I know what's going to be allowed, and not be at risk that four members of the Board of Appeals will grant a variance to expand a structure which is already adequate under the zoning ordinance. It may not be adequate for the pages, but certainly adequate under the zoning ordinance for somebody to live in. And that's the point I was making.
So just to clarify it, so I understand, you're suggesting that the practical difficulty standard would prevent a property owner from expanding an existing residence?
I'm saying that in fact, and I made this point to the city council early on in the process, and then I told them also that I would make a lot of money out of this zoning ordinance if they adopt it. and I'm here today, I guess, to prove that. But the fact, because there's so many provisions in the state statute which are going to ultimately end up being adjudicated by the court, this is just one of them. This is just the first of the problems I'm going to talk to you about tonight with this particular ordinance. But the fact is that the town could have adopted this provision along with, or kept on the books, the undue hardship variance, or adopted the demonstrated need variance. There's a demonstrated need variance which allows a 20% reduction. Some board members may be aware of this. These are options which are available under state law. And the last of those that I talked about, demonstrated need, for example, in the town of Falmouth, that's available as well as an undue hardship variance. The town of Cape Elizabeth chose, against my suggestion, they chose to substitute this for those other mechanisms. They didn't adopt any of the other options that are available under state law. The 20% demonstrated need variance actually works very nicely. The fact is that it would apply to and allow expansions of existing structures. But they chose not to go with that one. The fact is, we have to deal with the ordinance they did adopt, which is this one. And I'm just saying that just because they adopted new standards doesn't mean that you should give variances to everyone who shows up here saying, gee, I'd like to have a larger house than I'm allowed to have on the small lot that I have. The houses near me, or some of the houses near me, and we'll get to how many and what in a minute. I think that you're probably not going to have to even decide this issue that I'm raising now, because there's so many other things wrong with the application and the proof which has been put to you that I guess I should move on, because I've already been on this point for a while. But if
go ahead.
The board wants me to, I'll stay here. Let me say that the statutory requirement of significant economic injury isn't met in this particular case. The board is required to apply the plain meaning of the statutory requirement, and I'll get to the ordinance definition in a minute, because that does play into this. But you have to think about the statute and the ordinance as being two sets of regulations, and you have to comply with both of them, okay? The board is required to apply the plain meaning of the statutory requirement the applicant demonstrate a significant economic injury. This requirement demands proof of economic loss measurable in dollars and cents. That's the common understanding of economic. Economic means money or something capable of being quantified in dollars. And I haven't heard it tonight. The mere proof that the Pages can't build a certain size structure on their lot, as others have done on larger lots in the area, which is the additional town ordinance definition we'll get to in a minute, or that the Page family is too large for the house that they purchased last year, isn't proof of significant economic loss. The board is required to deny the variance if the applicant can't meet the plain meaning of the statutory requirement of significant economic injury. I'll get to the ordinance provision now. The ordinance definition of significant economic injury is made pursuant to a provision in state law in the Zoning Enabling Act, the section on zoning on boards of appeals, 4353.4. I don't know if you all have a copy of that. I'll give you a copy when we finish. Under its home rule authority, a municipality may, in an ordinance adopted pursuant to the subsection, adopt additional limitations to the granting of variances from the dimensional standards of a zoning ordinance. So that means you can adopt, the municipality can adopt additional limitations beyond those which are already in state law. And they did that in Cape Elizabeth by adding those additional provisions which say, notwithstanding the standards for dimensional variances. But in addition, Cape Elizabeth adopted a number of definitions of state terms. And it's up to you normally to interpret what's in the statute. It's not usually the place of the municipality to spell out what the legislature meant. They can add additional limitations to the grant of variances, but they can't say, by this provision the legislature meant you should look at X, Y, and Z. The town of Cape Elizabeth imposed a further limitation on the statutory requirement of significant economic injury by adopting a definition which includes, in addition to the plain meaning of significant economic injury under the state statute, a requirement the applicant demonstrate that the requested variance is for a structure of comparable size and location and number to other properties in the immediate neighborhood, and in no case fewer than 10 of the nearest properties. So we submit that the applicant is required to prove both the statutory requirement as well as the ordinance requirement. I'm going to deal tonight, from now on, with the ordinance requirement on that and show you how they haven't met that either. The pages can meet this ordinance requirement only by evidence establishing the size and location of the lot on at least 10 of the nearest properties. The information submitted by the applicants contains only square footage on the ground floor, because that's the way the assessor's records are kept. All of those numbers that you see there are ground floor numbers, just as they were on the Page's house, the 900 square feet. Every one of those is just a ground floor coverage. It doesn't tell you what they have for second floor. It doesn't tell you what the volume of the structure is. Now, granted, there are photographs which are given to you in connection with those, and we'll go through them in a minute, and you'll see that that's not a meaningful way to present the evidence, and that, in fact, the structures in the vicinity do not support a finding that the proposed structure would be comparable. There's no way we've already been through the difficulty of relating the documents you're given, which are just the street numbers, and to the chart block and lot, and I will attempt to help you do that because I've done that. I went to the assessor's office and I interpolated between them, and I think I've got most of those for you tonight, just so that you can resolve this issue. But there is no way still to compute the actual size of any of the structures using the submissions of the applicants. Not only, or the submissions I'm going to give you in addition, not only is the page's evidence devoid of information as to size, it fails to show the structures are comparable in their location. The word location is important. They have to be comparable in their location on the lot. That's what the ordinance definition says. There's no plot plan showing the relationship of any of the structures to the lot on which it sits. Neither the front nor rear setbacks is ascertainable. None of the properties are shown to be comparable in location, where all of the properties are required to be comparable. Let me say that again. All of the properties, all the 10 nearest structures, as I read that provision, it has to be comparable to all of the 10, or at least not, if some of them are really big, that's okay. But you can't have some that are going to be significantly smaller than what they're asking for out of those 10. And I think if you read it, you'll read it carefully, read the definition carefully, I think you can't reach any other conclusion, because when we go down and we talk about the definition of undesirable change to the character of the neighborhood, there we're talking about averaging. When we're talking about the definition of significant economic injury, we're talking about looking at the specific 10 nearest properties. At least the nearest 10 properties. You can look more, but you have to look at least at the nearest 10. Okay, let me show you, let me get into the maps and maybe we can shed some light on what is actually going on here and what the actual neighborhood looks like. I made a copy of a portion of a map. I forget what this map is called, but I'm sure the code enforcement officer can tell us what it is. It's a map. It's not actually the zoning map. Sorry, what's the name? The map that this is, it shows the houses on the left. Or the one up on your wall. The one up on the wall.
Oh, it's a zoning map.
It is the zoning map, okay. I made a copy.
Oh, you mean with the houses on it? No, it's a floodplain map.
Floodplain map, that's right, it's a floodplain map. I forgot. I made copies of the, of a portion of the floodplain map. They were the applicant.
The board will permit the evidence, however.
Yeah, they were the applicant to the board. This is what I was able to put together since last Friday, really, when we got into this thing. And we weren't able to have any meaningful discussions.
Could I make one comment? I'm not a board member, but...
Sure, Bruce.
If everybody's trying to determine that possibly what's submitted is incomplete or inaccurate, and because the applicants didn't have this on their application to begin with as something they needed to submit, but only submitted because I asked them to, because I thought there was a potential where you might ask for this, rather than try to prove that it's incomplete or not complete or complete, if indeed the board comes to consensus that maybe this should be finalized better, wouldn't it behoove the board and the applicant and anybody that's against it to table this, to have that submission completed?
Well, that may very well be the end result of the hearing tonight, but I don't know that yet. I don't know that that's...
Well, I mean, that's what I'm hearing is happening here. And well,
inclination. My preference would be to permit Mr. Laurie and the Lakemans to complete their presentation, and then we can decide whether we think we need additional information.
Thank you. I would hope that when we conclude that you will be able to determine that the standards aren't met, period. Not just a lack of proof, but in fact that they're not met. And it is unusual to allow an applicant to come back after making a full presentation. They could have done that if they'd wanted to before when the board had questions. Anyway, let me go through these and see if I can make some sense out of what's going on here. I also have copies of the particular, they're larger and therefore more readable copies. I'm gonna lose this stuff that I put down here. Of the, Assessor's Sheet 15, which I'm going to pass out to the board.
Can I ask a question, Mr. Laurie?
Yes.
I just want to make sure I understand what you're trying to assert. The language that I have says, in no case, fewer than 10 of the nearest property owners. Are you trying to assert that language should be interpreted to say the 10 nearest property owners?
I'm saying that they do have to meet. They do have to be comparable to at least the nearest 10.
Yes, sir.
They can go further.
Okay, that's what I'm asking you. You're saying at least the nearest 10, not
yes.
10 of, at least 10 of the nearest, because the language in the ordinance says 10 of the nearest.
I don't see any, 10 of the nearest out of.
10 of the nearest.
But how many?
Well, I'm saying...
I mean, nearest. Yeah, I understand what you're saying.
There's some latitude in the ordinance, and I'm asking if you're trying to assert that the ordinance should be interpreted as the 10 nearest.
I think that that's what it was intended to be. I think that they wanted, I think that when this was drafted, they wanted it to be, how to put it, they saw no harm if everyone in the area had very narrow setbacks to allow someone to build out further. So it's consistent with the neighborhood. But I think that you couldn't, I don't think that because there are a number of structures in the area, and I drew a circle, an arbitrary circle on that map that I passed out, and it is purely arbitrary. It's not necessarily what the neighborhood is. Could be more, could be less. But the fact is that I am saying that the intention, I think the intention of that provision was to say that you can't build out more than your neighbors. And I think that's the only way to make sense out of it. I think that to adopt a different interpretation would be to leave it wide open, because they haven't defined what the immediate neighborhood is or anything else. They've tied it to the 10 neighbors. When you get to the average later on, we'll see that they don't meet the average setback anyway, so it doesn't probably won't make any difference in the end. But why don't we go through this? And yes, I'm submitting that they do have to meet every one of them. They do have to. They can't be any closer to the road than any of those 10. And they can't be any larger in volume. It says size, but size must mean something more than square footage on the ground. We don't know what any of these structures are from what's been submitted today, but we submit that there are a number of them which are smaller in volume than the 2,380 square feet that they're going to be asking for. 23, I guess. Anyway. See, now I lost my train of thought. 1 second. Okay, now, the significance of this plan that I passed, the first plan that I passed out, the 8.5 by 11 sheet, which has a circle on it, is that it shows where houses are on lots, okay? Which houses have lots on them. A couple of times it's hard to tell because of the printing on the page. You know, sometimes the lettering covers an area and it's hard to tell, for example, where it says Two Lights Road, the D kind of obscures a house. And there may be another house in there somewhere, but you can see that there are houses further along Two Lights Road anyway. And you can see that throughout on that map. That doesn't help you a lot because it doesn't have the actual zoning parcels on it. That's why I passed out tax map, and I've attempted to indicate on there, you'll see some orange markings. Those are the properties which I either couldn't identify based on their submissions or were not included in their submissions, okay? And the reason why I went up Two Lights Terrace is that you have something in your pile. I made another copy of them because I couldn't quite see it out. I went through the records at the assessor's office trying to identify what the property was. It's this one. I can't describe it. It says on a Two Lights Terrace. I couldn't figure out which one that was. Now, maybe that's number 37, but that got me asking the clerk in the... Well, I'll wait till you all get that. Yeah, I had something else. Oh, here it is. I lost it here. Right. That got me looking for what was, in fact, on Two Lights Terrace, and they pulled out four cards from me. Those are the four properties that you see in orange there, 9, 10, 11, and 55. And I found that it wasn't any of them. But I did find some interesting things among those four properties. I'm sorry, I was going to get something.
Just one of each.
Yes. Yeah, there's. Just going to move about two. These, these properties, the first. I already passed out the one with the unknown, the one I couldn't find. Going up Two Lights Terrace, we look at number. Okay. We look at number 9. You can see it's obviously set back much more than 18 feet from the road. It's a one-story frame, which according to the assessor's record, and it looks like it is only one story, is only 560 square feet. That's a wood deck that's attached to it. The EFP, I believe, is 'enclosed frame porch', is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, enclosed frame porch. So maybe you'd add in the 98 feet from that, but you wouldn't normally include the deck. Anyway, so you're basically getting to a 600, you're getting to a structure which is approximately half what the Page's structure presently is, on that one. Going further, if you look at lot number 10, which is actually, I guess it's lot number 10, it looks like it's a big house. It's it looks like it's a large structure compared to the Page's proposed house, but if you turn it over, you'll see that it's only 1,090 square feet, in fact, and when you look at it, that's actually the size of it because it doesn't have a basement. It's cut out of the hillside there. It's got the garage underneath. And again, it's not really support for a large structure to be built on another lot. If you look at the U1511, you got a ranch, which is set back far more than 18 feet from the road. It's a small ranch. It's almost supporting the application, but as I said before, it doesn't meet the location comparability standard. It's way back, and you know these lots are not huge lots, but they are larger than the one we're talking about without the. Same problems that are on that lot. And if you look at number 55, I guess it is here, I cut off, I think when I copied it, You can see that's a split level one, and that's only 788 feet, I guess, is what the indications are on it. Hard to read, but it's 788 feet, I believe. Square feet. So again, you know, the choice not to go up there, you know, I don't know whether it's selective or whether they just thought that they were outside of their immediate neighborhood or not, but, you know, there isn't any support for it, and that, an extension of that neighborhood, to answer Mr. Keneally's question, and I don't think there's much support for it in the other structures we're going to visit in a minute. If you look at Two Lights Road, for some unknown reason, they chose not to go down Two Lights Road and pick up, I guess, their houses on 68, 69, and then we go off onto the other, onto the next tax map, and there are houses there as well. If you look at the map that I passed out, it shows where the houses are, and those aren't, no information is given on those, although they're, in fact, closer than some of the others that we see here. So I think you can play all kinds of games if you start talking about, you know, what the neighborhood is and how far you reach for the neighborhood and so forth. But what we've got here before us is stuff which, or information which is raw and not usable for the purposes of determining any, whether any of the statutory criteria, whether any of the ordinance criteria are met. The expanded page structure will be larger than some of the 10 closest structures, and those are ones that were passed as well. Um, 16 Beacon Lane, which is the Doyle House that people talked about earlier, which was expanded, I think. It does say old on the, at least on the property tax record that I have here, it says old on it. And then the photograph shows the upstairs on it. So I think that's the answer to the confusion we're having before. I need a bigger lip on this thing. My stuff keeps flowing off of it. Beacon Lane, as I said a moment ago, was 744 feet. Now it's about the size, now it's comparable in size to what the Page's house presently is at 1,200 square feet in total. And it'll be a lot smaller than the Page's new structure if you approve this variance. Again, you've got a wood deck and so forth on it. But anyway, when it was expanded, it came up to about the level of the Barry property, which is 17 Beacon Lane. Too many papers here.
What is the tax map number of 16 Beacon Lane?
I believe that that is 15-6. I'm going to look at that and see if that's right. 15-3. That's that little one there in the middle on the tax map. The small lot. So you see, if you compare the proposed Page house, it's going to be significantly larger, not comparable to either the Barry one or the other. See, on the Barry one, I think it's volume. When it says size, you really have to consider the volume of the structure. You consider how high the roof goes and everything else. because that's the only way that would make any sense when you talk about size. Certainly, it's not footprint on the ground. It's got to be something more than that, and I don't think you can leave the roofs out either. I think you have to look at the entire structure and see if it's comparable in size. And, you see on the Barry one, in fact, they've got an attached garage on too, which in this case, if you're going to compare them, you would really have to add in the garage that the Pages already have too. The Pages do have a garage. It doesn't show up on their plan. I don't see it anywhere on here, but there is a garage on the property in addition, on the Page property. So they do have a separate structure for the garage. So if you're going to compare apples to apples, you really need to add in their garage as well. I don't know the sizes of the garage. Something to be added, or else you should be subtracting the garages on the other properties when you look at them. So, we conclude that there's no way that the proposed 18-foot sideline setback is comparable in location to any of the 10 properties closest. Well, I'm sorry, I didn't give you that information yet. With regard to the size, there's no way, I think, that you can conclude that it's comparable to all of the 10. It may be comparable to some of the 10 properties in the vicinity, but I don't think you can even determine that on the evidence that was submitted to you. Certainly, it's not that everyone in the neighborhood has a larger house. Some people do, and some people don't. With regard to the location, I asked the Lakemans recently to take a look out there and see what the setbacks are. They knew the setback on their property is in fact 60 feet from their house to Beacon Lane. And they looked at 20 Beacon Lane, and that looked to be about 35 feet. 17 Beacon Lane is about 22 feet. 16 Beacon Lane is about 24 feet. 15 Beacon Lane is about 30 feet. 10 Beacon Lane is about 35 feet. 176 Two Lights Road is about 30 feet. 175 Two Lights Road is about 60 feet. 168 Two Lights Road, I asked them to go in both directions on that. 168 Two Lights Road is about 18 feet. And 162 Two Lights Road is 25 feet. So really, there is only one property in the whole area that's comparable to the proposed setback of 18 feet, and that's a Two Lights at 168 Two Lights Road at 18 feet. The others are significantly larger, and the average, we'll get to the average and how the average works in a minute, the average is almost 34 feet, 33 and a half feet. But these were guesstimates when you look at them.
Were those measurements actually taken, or are they approximate?
They're very approximate. They're very approximate, but the difference is significant enough.
Very approximate as in very close to being actual, or very approximate as I think.
But we do know that the Lakeman's property is at least 60 feet back. That much is certain. The rest of them, we don't have precise measurements on. But, as was stated earlier by your counsel, the applicants have the burden of showing that, in fact, they meet the standard here and that they will not be any closer than the comparable structures under this standard. That's the 10 that are nearby, or under the ordinance definition of undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood, they have to show that they're not any closer than any of them. Here we're talking about a setback which is on the Lakeman property, which is three times that of the proposed Page addition, and the others are two or three times as well. So it's not, when I say it's not precise, maybe it's not even necessarily accurate, but it certainly is a ballpark, that there are significantly larger setbacks on these properties. Turning now to the ordinance definition, which is an additional requirement. This is the undesirable change in the neighborhood, character of the neighborhood standard. It says that the board has to determine that the variance will not allow a structure which is either larger or closer to the road or the property lines than the average of the nearest 10 principal structures. Okay. So here we have an average of the nearest 10. I don't know which are exactly the nearest 10. Seems pretty, we can see though, looking at this map, we get some idea of who the nearest 10 is, the map, the floodplain map. And based on that, it shows the properties at, as I said before, at 22 Beacon Lane, and the other properties. I gave you the setbacks on a moment ago. I won't go through them all again, but the fact is that how to put it, the average of that is well over 30.
Mr. Dollar, is that from the Cape Elizabeth zoning manual you're reading that?
I'm sorry?
Is that from the Cape Elizabeth zoning manual?
Yeah, the zoning ordinance definition section. Um, 19.1.3 states the definition of undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood, which is one of the criteria on your list there, the result of a variance where the structure is larger or closer to the road or property lines than the average of the nearest 10 principal structures. And then there it is, clearly, the nearest 10 principal structures. Well, they spell principal wrong, but that's all right. Or in the case of a variance request for an accessory structure, the nearest 10 accessory structures. So you're going to look at the nearest 10 and figure out what the average is, or at least conclude that they have or have not established that they will be comparable. Not even comparable. It can't be larger and it can't be closer. That's the ordinance standard. It cannot be larger and it cannot be closer than that average. They haven't given you any evidence to determine that. We've given you evidence which indicates strongly that that's the case, that it will be closer and it might be larger, it might well be larger than the average. But the bottom line is that the they cannot meet the standard of showing they won't be closer to the road than the average. They are closer to the road than the average. Nobody else is at 18. One of the properties is at 18. That's it. How did you compute the 18 feet? I'm sorry. Do you want to come to the mic for a second and explain how you reached those conclusions?
My van is 16 feet long. I drove into each of the driveways, and then I guesstimated the distance to the house. So the 16 feet I'm certain of. And then actually we walked around and I had Dan guesstimate and we were very close, so.
So where it was 30 something feet, it was at least two car lengths. And if it was 50 feet, it was at least three car lengths.
Right, and sometimes like on the Berry property, there's a fence with 8 foot lengths of fence, so it wasn't difficult. But it definitely is a guesstimate, as I told David.
And for the record, you are Mrs. Lakeman?
Yes, at 22 Beacon Lane. Right?
Thank you.
I'm sorry for not introducing her. This is Dan Lakeman as well. If you have questions later on, they're both available. Well, that was an awful lot to bite off, but I'm going to give you a couple of more issues in this case before I finish. This is a classic case of self-created hardship. The practical difficulty is due solely to the decision of the Pages to buy a house that was too small for them, which was located on a lot which was too small for the Pages to expand it lawfully. The statute requires that there be no feasible alternative to a variance as well, and doesn't define that term. Again, the town ordinance adds a requirement by definition. this definition isn't binding on the board, at least to the extent that it may purport to create any lesser standard, because as I said before, the authority of a municipality is only to add additional limitations to the state variance statute, not to make it more liberal. They can't make it more liberal. Everyone knows that, and the statute says it. So, the question here is, if the board should conclude that the practical difficulty results from the applicant's family being too large for the house they purchased, the board then should conclude that the harm is self-created because they bought into it. The fact is that although the law court used to have an ironclad rule that if you bought a lot, a substandard lot, with knowledge of the zoning, and it didn't make a difference if you had actual knowledge or not, it was constructive knowledge was enough, because everybody's supposed to know what the laws are. If you bought a vacant lot, which is substandard, you should have known that you couldn't build on it, and you can't come in and get a variance because it was self-created. The court relaxed that rule a couple of years ago. They say now that it is not doesn't necessarily preclude you from getting a variance, but it is a factor to be considered, along with other factors that the board uses in deciding whether to grant a variance or not. And the self-created hardship rule would be meaningless if you were to allow someone to come in and buy a small property with an even smaller house on it, and then be allowed to come in and get a right to expand that on the basis that everybody else has one, and I ought to have one too. The practical difficulty here is that they have a harm which is self-created. They had a large family, or at least they got a four-person family at the moment anyway, but they want to have a large house on. This is not the lot to have a large house on. They made the choice to put it there, and the town of Cape Elizabeth and the Lakemans should not have to deal with a large house on that property. They may choose to move 2 years from now after they build an addition, and somebody else will move in there with four kids or with an extended family, because there'll be the potential for having three or four or five bedrooms there. And this lot can't support that. That's what zoning is about. It's supposed to protect the neighboring properties, in terms of setbacks. And that's what you're here for, is to, in fact, say no when it's warranted. You're not here just to say yes. I know it's harder to say no than to say yes. And it's hard for the Lakemans to come here and each time and be portrayed as the bad guy for simply trying to keep the benefit of what they originally purchased. They wanted to live at this location with a small house across the way from them. They use their yard a lot, and they don't want the activity associated with a large house and a large family across the way. And that's what the zoning ordinance is about. That's not an unreasonable position, and there's no reason why they should have to be here defending themselves year after year against variance requests to do this.
Mr. Lawrence, may I ask another question?
Yes.
Maybe clarification. You've expressed a couple of times the fear that this house could eventually grow to be four or more bedrooms, and made a comment early on that septic system was sized to support that. I understood that the septic system was sized to be slightly oversized for three bedrooms, but not adequate for four bedrooms or more.
I don't know whether that's true, but the septic system...
the numbers that were laid out, I believe.
That's correct.
I thought you said that that in fact the oversize was enough to be a fourth bedroom.
No.
It doesn't make a difference because the septic system could be expanded later on too.
I'm just trying to correct something that
I understand what you're saying, and someday it may even be sewered, and at that point, not in our lifetimes perhaps, who knows, Cape Elizabeth.
But no, I'm just trying. I think
your point is well taken.
The foundation was not laid for a larger house.
Hmm?
It was not. Yep. Any indication that there was a foundation built for a larger house?
No, I understand that, but what I'm saying is that the number of bedrooms could be changed in the future, and it doesn't make any difference, and so can the septic system. The bottom line is that if you give a variance to make the small house into a large house, You have the potential for having a large family there. And we have no, Lakemans have no desire to see the Page family have fewer bedrooms than they would like to have inside of their house. The fact is that if you build it, they will come. And if this becomes a larger house, it's going to be, the pressure is going to be the next person moving into it, if not the Pages, to in fact expand, in fact have more bedrooms. Perhaps they'll be back for further variance at that point in time, who knows. But the fact is that the Lakemans are here in opposition, and we keep on hearing over and over again that they don't know why, that the applicant doesn't know why. Well, part of the reason why the applicant doesn't know why they're here is because they never asked them. And the fact is that the Lakemans want to have their peace and quiet. They bought a house of a type they wanted, at a location they wanted, with in a neighborhood that they wanted, and in fact, they should be, they have a legitimate right to do that. And I almost started laughing when Mike Traister started talking about them not having standing. They are abutters, of course they have standing. The courts have been very clear on that. They have standing regardless. They don't have to show harm to the courts, and they shouldn't have to show harm here. They have a right to have the zoning remain the way it is on this property. And they have a right to come in, just as the applicant has a right to come in and try to meet the ordinance standards, they have a right to come in and oppose that. And it's unfortunate, you know, and I would hope that you won't make us come back again to allow the applicant to come back with more information. That's unusual in this case. You know, the fact is that second bites of the apple are generally not allowed in these kinds of proceedings. You ought to decide it without putting the Lakemans to the expense of bringing me back and preparing for another hearing on perhaps new evidence. You know, we've dealt with the evidence that they came up with. We've shown you that they can't meet some of the ordinance standards. They cannot meet some of the ordinance standards. They cannot meet the average setback. They're going to be closer than the average of houses in the area. There's no doubt about that. So why drag it out, and why do we have to come back again so they can have another bite of the apple? That's what we're worried about at this point.
May I ask you to, this is the result of a variance where the structure is larger or closer to the road of property, but the new structure is no closer to the property lines than the existing structure, so it does not change the character of the structure in any way, does it?
Well, it does, because it's extending out. It's an additional area. They're asking for permission to locate closer than the zoning ordinance allows. And they're asking to come closer on that sideline than the average of properties in the area. They're increasing the nonconformity by doing that.
I understand that, but they're not expanding the nonconformity.
Sorry?
What I'm saying is they're not expanding that. I'm unclear a little bit on how to interpret this wording since it's our first time dealing with it. And they're not expanding the nonconformity, and so I just wonder whether or not that really doesn't result in...
No, they're expanding the nonconforming structure. It's not the use. The use is a conforming use. They're expanding the structure in a way that's nonconforming to the ordinance. That's why they're here for a variance. And they're saying the result of the variance, where the structure is larger or closer to the road or the property line than the average, okay? They can't, their structure is already closer than the average. I mean, it goes to 3 feet or something like that. If you were to read that to apply to the entire structure, they couldn't even be here. We're saying, we're taking a reasonable interpretation of that and saying that must mean the portion of the structure that they're proposing to build, the addition. And the addition is going to be closer than any other structure than the average structure in the area, you know, and maybe if you, you know, I just don't see how you can read that other than giving its plain meaning of the structure which they're proposing, which is the addition. Otherwise, they couldn't be here at all if we're looking at their whole structure. And I don't see how you can say that because their house is already practically encroaching on the road, that the putting on of an addition doesn't have to be justified under these standards. You know, the standard applies whether they're building an addition or they're building a new structure. And the fact that they're already, portions of their house are already closer than the 18 feet doesn't justify them in building out either to the same extent as that the present encroachment, or to a lesser extent if they don't meet the ordinance standard. And the ordinance standard is that their new structure can't be any closer than the average. Does that answer your question, or you want to?
Well, it clarifies your interpretation. Yeah, I'm not sure I agree with it, but I think it's a little bit subject to interpretation.
Well,
So under your interpretation, Mr. Lorry, if you had a street with 10 homes on it, all of which were in compliance with the 25-foot setback, assuming that to be the setback, and the 11th home wanted to build an addition that encroached into the setback by 3 feet, the 11th home would be requesting for a structure that is closer to the road than the average of the other property owners, and it would therefore be an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood.
That's right.
And they would not be permitted to do it.
There's a common ordinance provision, I think this is modeled on, that where you've got non-conforming structures along the street that frequently allows people building next to those non-conforming structures to come out to the common boundary line rather than taking up the new setback. You don't want to see one house 50 foot back when everybody else on the street is 20 feet back. You know, it looks sort of funny. So that's what this is about. But it doesn't mean that you can take this and say, oh, never mind, I've answered your question. And that's a common ordinance provision nowadays to have this kind of average setback on the same side of the street for non-conforming structures, but it doesn't allow you to build out normally. And they put that into the ordinance as a standard because they're trying to give you some guidance. You know, I think the council, I spoke to the council about how you're going to be at sea under these provisions, and I think they tried to give you some guidance by putting this stuff in there. I don't think that they succeeded, because I think what they succeeded in doing is giving you additional standards to apply in addition to the ones you've got to apply anyway under state law. But anyway, to sum up, and then I'll sit down unless you have more questions. The board is required to determine whether a practical difficulty exists under the statute and as defined in the ordinance. The pages of the applicants, and have the burden of proof on all the issues, pages have simply not demonstrated the strict application of the ordinance to their property precludes them from pursuing a use permitted in the zoning district, nor have they shown that the strict application of the ordinance results in a significant economic injury, whether under the plain meaning of the requirement or the ordinance definition. Nor have the pages demonstrated that a variance allowing an 18-foot setback would not allow a structure larger or closer to the street than the average of the 10 nearest principal structures. Lakeman's further request that the board make additional findings that practical difficulty is self-created and that there are feasible alternatives to the pages to meet the needs of the of their own family at a different location. And I think that you're allowed to do that because the statute doesn't limit you in terms of other feasible alternatives to this lot. The ordinance proposes that as a standard. I don't think that the ordinance can do that because it's more liberal than the state statute. But in any case, I have copies of portions of my remarks anyway, not the complete thing, along with the state statute. Find them and give them out. the back, on the last page, you'll find the state statute, so you'll have that along with the local ordinance, which you have, I believe you all have, and any questions before I sit down?
Questions for Mr. Lurie?
I'm still trying to understand your objection to on the use basis. As I understand the ordinances in general, you're allowed to build up to 25% of your lot, Bruce? Was it 20%?
You can have a maximum footprint coverage of 20% on septic system.
Okay, so it's a permitted use to build a residence that occupies 20%, the footprint occupies 20%.
Uh-huh.
And if that 20% were to be used for residence, then do not the pages then have a hardship because by virtue of the imposition of setback requirements, that use of their property for residents occupying 20% of the total property, which in this case would be 4,000 plus square feet, 5,200 square feet? Yeah, 20% of 13,000 square feet, that because of the existence of the imposition of setbacks imposed since the time of the construction, that they're being denied a use and hence have a practical difficulty.
I don't agree because the ordinance itself contains, if you look at page 48, it contains a prohibition. So it's notwithstanding the definition of dimensional standards in 30 MRSA 3353-4C, no variance shall be granted to permit a use or structure otherwise prohibited. It's right there anyway. That what you're saying is that provision, which talks about a use being precluded, is mere surplusage, that it has no meaning, it has no significance, that it means something that has no meaning.
Is it a permitted use?
This provision.
If they met setbacks, would it be a permitted use to build a 2,100 square foot structure? Is that a permitted use in a residential zone, provided you met setbacks?
Yeah.
Okay.
It would be.
And so they could theoretically occupy 20% of their 13,000 square feet.
But that's not the variance that they're asking.
I'm not asking. I was asking about, you said that's not a permitted use. And as I read the ordinances, building a 2,100 square foot house is a permitted use if you don't occupy more than 20% of the land. So then the question is, they have a practical difficulty with reference to that permitted use because of the imposition of setbacks.
That would be a good analysis if they're asking for a variance from the 20% requirement, from the lot coverage requirement. They're not asking for that. They're asking for a reduction in the setback. They're asking for a variance as to the setback.
And I just want to establish that there's a permitted use here, and I thought you were saying
it is,
that the expansion was not a permitted use.
No, the permitted use
is residential.
No, I'm not. I'm saying that residential uses are permitted in the zone. Okay, there's no question about that, right? And what I'm saying is that they already have that permitted use. Okay, they already have the permitted residential use. What they don't, you know, if they were looking for a garage, you could grant this variance. If they're looking for a garage to put onto the property because they didn't have a garage, you could grant that because that would be a new use. It's an accessory use that's allowed in the zone. If they're a car dealer and they were looking for parking.
Can you get to your point? I'm really reaching for it now.
Oh, sorry? You're not getting
I can't get
point.
To your point.
Okay, my point is that you have use categories in the ordinance, okay? And the use categories include residential in the zone and a number of other uses in the zone, and then there are business zones where you have other uses which are allowed, other categories of business use which are allowed. You're also allowed to have in either a business zone or residential zone, you're allowed to have accessory uses mm-hmm. as well. And what I'm getting to is that you're allowed to have the residential use here. You're not precluded from having the residential use by reason of the dimensional variance. Now you're saying yes, you are precluded because you can't have the one you want. You can't have as big a residential use as you want. You can't have the expansion of the residential.
I'm asking you if you recognize that a permitted use of a property is to occupy 20% of it with a structure. Is that a permitted use, all of the things being equal?
That is not a permitted use as such in the zone. That's a dimensional requirement in the zone. A permitted use is an activity that you carry on, like living there, carrying on a business. That's a use.
And you're saying
the use,
I thought you were saying something different, because the use is going to be clearly residential, and you seem to be saying that this use cannot be extended. What strikes me, I thought you're not extending the use if you're not making it anything other than residential. So if you're going on that side of the argument, then I don't understand it either.
Well, what I'm saying is that you already have a residential use there. It's a permitted use in the zone. You're not precluded from having that use because you already have it.
Yeah, right.
Okay. So the question here is, can you expand it under this provision?
And that's my question. How is keeping it residential expanding its use?
It's not keeping it residential. You're expanding the residential use on the property by building the larger structure.
No, an expanded use is, as you just pointed out, a change in using it for a business, using it for a boat repair facility, using it for that would be a change in use or an expansion of use. But when you said expansion, I thought you were referring to a dimensional thing. And then it seems to me it's a permitted expansion to occupy 20% of your land. If you're not having a different use, then you're not expanding the use. So I don't understand your argument.
It's permitted. My argument is that you have to give some significance to the words precluded, preclusion. You have to be precluded from using your property that way, okay, by reason of the dimensional requirements of the ordinance. You have to be precluded from using your property for a particular use, which is one which is permitted in the zoning ordinance. Let's say this was a car dealership or something, okay? This is an area which is zoned for car dealerships. I tried to give you the example of garage and accessory use, and apparently explain it. So I could try some other instances.
Residence is not an accessory use. And that's
that's exactly what I'm saying. I'm saying what they're asking for here is a use that they already have. They're not precluded from having it on this property. They're allowed to have the residential use. They already have the residential use on the property. Okay?
And another permitted use is to build a residence. And you're saying that by that standard, nobody would ever be allowed to enhance their residence, because it would be expanding an already existing use, even if they met setback requirements.
And I think that's the way you have to read the statute. I think that if the town wants to allow people to expand their residential uses, they need to adopt the demonstrated need variance or some other form of variance. They cannot do it under this provision.
Everybody who adds addition to the house needs a use variance? Does everybody who expands a house need a use variance?
No, they don't need a variance at all unless they don't meet the dimensional
A use variance would be a change in use. And you're saying that to expand a residential use is a change in use?
No, I'm not saying it's a change of use at all. What I'm saying is it's a use that they already have on the property. Therefore, it's not a use that they're precluded from having on the property. You have to be precluded. You have to be unable to have that use on the property but for the variance.
No, it doesn't say that. It doesn't say that. It says precludes the ability to pursue a use. It doesn't say create a use. It says pursue a use.
I understand.
It doesn't have to be a new use. It can be pursuing a use that already is there.
Well, that's not the way I read it, and, you know, I argue about that.
I think that's what Bob was saying. You're reading it as extension of an existing use is not covered by this, but I disagree with that. I think Bob does too.
Well,
the wording says pursue a use.
The
it doesn't say create a use. It says pursue a use. That can be in a current use.
Yeah, the alternative is if you read it the other way, then it has no significance because you've already got a prohibition on having a use or structure which is otherwise.
No, it certainly has significance because we're talking about what uses are permitted. There are certain uses permitted and certain uses not. So as long as one is pursuing, not creating, pursuing a permitted use, that's what the language is all about.
Well, I guess if somebody wanted a variance to put in a boat repair facility, which is permitted, or a fish market, then I think you might have a case, because that would be a new use, a variance for a new use. But as far as seeking a variance, and you're saying you're extending the already existing use, I'm with Jack. I don't understand your argument.
No. My argument is that that's already prohibited. If you want to put in a fish sale, a fish place there, you can do it.
It's permitted.
It's prohibited in the zone.
No, it's not prohibited. It's permitted. Hmm? It's prohibited. It's permitted.
Well, rather than pursue this line of argument indefinitely, yeah. And it seems that we could certainly do that.
All right.
I think, Mr. Lorry, you've made your point very clearly. Obviously, at least two members of the board take issue with you on your reading of it, but
I hear you.
that we understand. Is there anything else, Mr. Lorry, that to be presented on behalf of the Lakemans in opposition to the application?
Do you have anything on that? Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, as I said in the outline that I passed out to you, we did, and there was some discussion about the communications between me and Mr. Traister about the so-called interest in the land across the way or whatever. That all resulted in a agreement to mediate. We tried not to be here tonight in opposition to this thing. And we asked them to table this so that we could have further discussions with them. And at one point there was an agreement to mediate, to go to mediation. And as I've indicated in the notes that I sent you, the Lakemans went out and procured the services of a mediator on the terms that were agreed upon, and at that point in time, it was decided by the Pages that they weren't interested in mediation. And afterwards, they said they offered to go to mediation, but Mary Page alone would participate in that mediation. And that wasn't going to make any sense, you know, because it wasn't going to result in any kind of a meaningful discussion. You know, as I said before, you know, we're only here because no one ever talks to the Lakemans. You kept on hearing over and over again how they changed their plans to accommodate the Lakemans, how they did this or that to accommodate the Lakemans, or they did this for the Lakemans. They actually did it to try to convince the board that the board should approve it despite the Lakeman's position. We've never had a meaningful discussion between the Pages and the Lakemans, and that's what Mrs. Lakeman asked me to impart to the board. And they're not here. They're not here because they like to fight with their neighbors. They're here because they feel that they have to, because this is the forum, and
Can I just ask one more question? You argued that it was a self-imposed hardship. As I understand the law, the hardship accrues to the land, no matter who purchases it. It's if the land has a hardship associated with it, then it's irrelevant who owns it or who bought it.
Variance passes with the land once it's determined that, in fact, the variance is warranted. The fact is that people are not supposed to, the whole variance scheme is not supposed to allow people to go in and buy property which exists in violation of the zoning ordinance and then expand the uses which are in violation of nonconformity and then expand it, because if you did, you wouldn't have a zoning ordinance. You know, that everybody would go and buy property. It's always worth more after you put more money into it. But, you know, as I said at the beginning, I don't see how you can decide this without some economic impact, economic injury, and there isn't one here. The extent of their injury is that they don't have the use of the property they would like to have of that property, of that house. And they bought it knowing that. They fixed it up knowing that. They could sell it and move on, which is probably what they ought to do if they want to have a bigger house. That's what that's what people do when they can't add on. They sell their house and move someplace else where they can have a bigger house.
Thank you, Mr. Lorry. Mr. Traister, you probably want to say something at this point.
I would just like to respond with
I'd like to suggest that since we've been sitting here for 2 hours and 42 minutes, that we take a 5-minute break, and I mean a 5-minute break, and that we return at 9:47 and let you respond at that point.
You're going to be talking next, right? Try to keep it like, not like right in front of your face, but like 3 or 4 feet.
concession. Mr. Traceman?
Traister.
Traceman, you may respond.
Thank you. As I'm sure the board might guess, I and the pages disagree with a great deal, if not the majority, of what Attorney Lori has just argued to the board. I think Attorney Lori has done a good job of trying to do what lawyers often try to do when they're opposing development applications on the behalf of clients, and that is to do their best to confuse the board. And I think that essentially what Attorney Lori has been arguing is that the board should ignore certain parts of the ordinance, should read other parts of the other requirements into the ordinance. Indeed, the pages have gone so far as to suggest that there are two practical difficulty standards which the pages and applicants in the town of Cape Elizabeth must meet. And we strongly disagree with that. But before I get to the legal merits of the arguments made by the pages, there are a few preliminary matters I feel compelled to object to. These are matters I didn't intend to get into this evening, but since they've been raised by the Lakemans, I feel I have to correct the record to the extent I can. First of all, there was some indication from Attorney Lori that the building is non-conforming and that the addition would be non-conforming as it went to the side lot line on the west. That is not the case. There is a tremendous amount of room from the existing home to the west boundary line. If the pages wanted to, I think that under the current ordinance, they could build out a one-level structure for foot after foot after foot after foot until they reach that setback to the west. They've chosen not to do that, and in a sense, they've chosen not to do it because it would presumably be more offensive to the neighborhood and to the Lakemans. That's why the current proposal is before this board this evening. We feel that it minimizes the impact on the neighborhood generally and the Lakemans specifically. Aside from that, Attorney Lori stated at the beginning of his remarks with respect to a settlement process, that settlement process was initiated by me, and that in response, he indicated that the pages intended to do some tree planting. And again, I didn't intend to get into this, but the fact of the matter is, I received a phone call from Attorney Lori asking specifically whether the pages may be willing to settle this matter with the Lakemans on a basis whereby the Lakemans could acquire rights in a small plot of land owned by the pages on the other side of Beekman Lane adjacent to the Lakemans property. In turn, I contacted the pages, discussed that opportunity, called Attorney Lori back, and made a settlement proposal, at which time Attorney Lori indicated to me that he misunderstood his clients and in fact did not have the authority to raise that issue with me, but that the acquisition of that land was only something that the Lakemans may want to possibly do in the future. And I'm willing to certainly accept that representation from Attorney Lori, but I just wanted to correct the record on how that discussion evolved. And regardless of the claim that that is not an issue, we certainly believe that at least in part what's driving this is a desire to acquire that land and to use this process to gain an advantage to do so. Regardless of that, the Lakemans have quite readily conceded that the real concern here is that there's a family living across the street and that they don't like that they bought their property which is situated within a densely populated residential neighborhood here in the town with the intentions of having privacy and that they simply do not want a family living across the street. That, members of the board, is not legally recognizable harm. That simply is not a lawful justification for opposing this application. Attorney Lori went on to state that simply because the Lakemans are abutters, they have legal standing, that they don't have to show harm. As Attorney Lori knows, that is false under the law court, the Maine Supreme Court's cases. It's a two-part test to come here before the board and to pursue this in a court of law. The first part is that you appear and participate before the board, which of course the Lakemans are doing this evening. But there's a second part, and the second part is that you make a demonstration of particularized injury or harm. And not wanting a family living across the street from you is not legally recognizable harm. It simply is not. That is no basis for opposing this application. The Lakemans have said the Pages are the ones to blame here, that they bought this property knowing the house was small and the lot was narrow, and that they should move. We would submit the Lakemans bought their property in the middle of a neighborhood. If they don't want families surrounding them, the Lakemans should move. It is not the Pages' burden to move, or any other resident of the town's burden, to move or to limit their size of their family to satisfy a neighbor. That is simply wrong. I think that common sense would tell every member of the board that. In addition, the Pages are living there. There already is a family consisting of two parents and two children at 172 Two Lights Road. The impact of that family living there is not going to increase one degree by having an additional living room and a bedroom. The family is already there. Nothing will change. There will be no increased harm. Essentially, the Lakemans are asking this board to elevate what they presume are their rights over the Pages' rights and the other neighbors in the neighborhood's rights. That is wrong. The Lakemans have essentially argued to this board what is legally known as an estoppel argument, that this board should deny the application because town official years ago when they bought the property represented that nothing could be done with this blight on the neighborhood, and that they purchased in reliance on that. I think if there's one thing that parties and everyone should be able to agree on is that this board does not have to resolve that issue. This board does not have jurisdiction to resolve an estoppel argument. The law court has relieved you of that obligation. That issue is not before the board. But regardless, the town has determined to amend its zoning ordinance. The ordinance has changed. And the courts have been clear for the better part of the last century, since zoning was first enacted. All property is held subject to the zoning power. And zoning can change. Zoning can change favorably, zoning can change negatively. The Lakemans are essentially arguing that this board frees the law and the state of affairs existing at the time they purchased their property. That is not the law that's governing this board. The law that's governing the board is set forth in this ordinance as amended and enacted effective August 10th, 2000. And under that, this law, this ordinance, residents of the town are entitled to a variance if they can prove practical difficulty under section 19.5.2. As we've argued, we meet that standard. The Lakemans are not entitled to rely on old law or different law. The law that is controlling this issue is the current ordinance, section 19.5.2, and the related definitional sections, as well as the state statute, which we'll get into in a moment. Now, Attorney Laurie has suggested that no addition to a home is entitled to a variance in the town of Cape Elizabeth, as I understand his argument. And I think as several members of the board have indicated, that's wrong. There's not a distinction between, excuse me, let me back up. The ordinance is clear on this point, and all the board need to do is to review the definitional sections relative to the practical variance standard, which talks about principal structures. Moreover, section 19.4.3.1, excuse me, 19.4.3.A.2 specifically contemplates that single lots that are developed, which are non-conforming, may be modified, enlarged, or relocated, or a new building structure constructed thereon. I'll repeat that, modified or enlarged, i.e., in addition, so long as you meet the performance standards set forth in subsection A of section 19.4.3. And that sets forth various setbacks, including the setbacks that the Page property is subject to of 25 feet. It goes on to say, you'll see at page 33, if a principal structure cannot be sited on a lot in conformance with the setback requirements, the owner may seek a variance. That's why we're here today. We're following the ordinance. We're seeking a variance pursuant to section 19.4.3 and 19.5.2. The ordinance does not distinguish between accessory and principal uses. It talks about uses. Specifically, practical difficulty definition. The strict application of the ordinance to a property precludes the ability of the property owner to pursue a permitted use. It doesn't say accessory uses. It doesn't say only garages. It doesn't say only decks. It's any use. We are pursuing a residential use that would otherwise be prohibited on that part of the page's property they wish to construct an addition on. There's no question about that. We clearly meet the mandate of the ordinance. And I would note also, it's my understanding that the town attorney agrees with our position on that. That is the ordinance the town has adopted. Not another ordinance that the Lakemans would like us to employ. Not additional requirements. This ordinance. The ordinance set forth Chapter 19 of the zoning ordinance effective August 10th, 2000. The Lakemans also argue that you must find that two practical difficulties are met. That's simply wrong. What the town has done is to promulgate a statute pursuant to an enabling act that the state legislature passed. That enabling act is 30A-4353, subsection 4C, which grants municipalities the authority to enact practical difficulty variances. I agree that you must meet the statutory mandate of practical difficulty. We don't even need to look at the statute for that because your own ordinance requires that. Practical difficulty is defined by your ordinance. That definition is a verbatim parallel of the state statute. However, the state statute does not define significant economic harm in any way. The Lakemans contend it has to be dollars and cents. Well, economic injury, while it may generally mean that, can mean more than that. In the town of Cape Elizabeth, has defined what it means in this town and has enacted an ordinance to tell this board what it means. And that's set forth on page 16 of your ordinance. That is the definition. The town has the authority to enact that definition. There is no express definition in the statute. In Maine, there's broad home rule authority. While the state statute does state that towns may impose additional limits to those set forth in the state statute, it does not say that towns can't define what undefined terms mean. Towns can do that and do that all the time under their home rule authority. The only thing that towns can't do is enact an ordinance or a definition which is offensive or contrary to the intent of the ordinance. Your definition doesn't do that. Your definition defines in Cape Elizabeth what significant economic harm means and what it means. It essentially exists when application of the ordinance would prevent the applicant from having a structure or accessory structure comparable in size, location, and number to those of other lot owners in the immediate neighborhood. That's what this town has decided economic harm is. It has every right to do that. That is the controlling standard here. There aren't two standards to meet. There's one standard to meet. The pages meet that standard. Attorney Laurie has submitted a variety of information about what the Lakemans view as comparable homes. If we look at this map that's been submitted, the Lakemans have chosen the orange lots. Why don't we choose Beacon Lane? That's the house, that's the road the house is located on. The pages have gone outside of Beacon Lane. They've chosen Two Lights Terrace. The pages have chosen the street they live on. And if you look at this map, if I'm interpreting it according to how I understand the Lakemans submitted to be interpreted, these numbers show the location of the structures, the houses. Well, if you go up Beacon Lane from west to east, look how close those houses are to the road. Those are the houses we should be looking at, not houses way down Two Lights Road to the west or way up on Two Lights Terrace to the east. We've chosen the houses on the street the pages live on. In addition, we certainly challenge the evidence that's been submitted by the Lakemans on the applicable set, on the setbacks to which lots in the adjacent neighborhood, or the existing setbacks in the lots of the, in the neighborhood. I don't think anybody can validly say what the setback is by walking down the street and taking a look or pulling their van up into somebody's driveway. And I'm frankly not sure how any applicant proves that without trespassing on the neighbor's property. But certainly the Lakeman's evidence of what the setbacks are is simply has no foundation. We're asking the board to employ its common sense. This board, all the members of the board are residents of the community. I don't know this for sure, but it's my understanding that many of you, if not all of you, are familiar with the Beacon Lane neighborhood, maybe have even done a site view prior to the hearing this evening. You are allowed under the law, under the Maine Supreme Court cases, to employ your own knowledge and common sense. And I think every member of this board knows that the Page's house at 172 Two Lights Road is undersized and that property is unique. There's no question about that. The pictures reflect that. That's additional evidence, but you're entitled to rely on your own knowledge. All we're asking is to construct an addition which is set back 12 to 15 feet from the existing house. What negative impact there could be from that is beyond me. There is no negative impact. It is further back from the existing structure. Further back, presumably, according to this tax map the Lakemans have submitted, the addition I'm referring to now is further back than it would appear than many of the houses, if not all of the houses, along what would be, I gather, the south side of Beacon Lane. There's no negative impact here. We simply would like to construct a modest addition for a living room and a bedroom set back further from the road than the existing house. I think that this project demands approval. There are no negative impacts. Certainly not wanting neighbors with children is not a recognizable harm and a negative impact that any court of law would recognize. It's simply not. And finally, to address the last legal point Attorney Lori made, he's essentially argued that the Pages created their own hardship. This was an issue I anticipated because it was argued last year by the Lakemans. The law is that buying property, whether or not you have knowledge of the need for a variance, and in this case, the fact of the matter is the Pages had no knowledge, constructive or actual, but the law is that is not self-created hardship, and I think that's exactly what the town attorney has opined to this board previously and last year, and in fact more recently. What that refers to in the no feasible alternative or self-created hardship criteria, is when you convey a portion of your lot and thereby cause the need for the variance. It's not buying property that may need a variance to construct a project on. And I'm going to quote for the board the Maine Supreme Court case of Rochelleau v. Town of Green, which was decided in 1998, and I think this should put any issue on this, any dispute to rest. Quote, knowledge of zoning ordinance restrictions by a purchaser of a non-conforming lot without more will hardly ever constitute a self-created hardship. For years, the general rule was that one who purchased property with actual or constructive knowledge of the restrictions of a zoning ordinance was barred from securing a variance. With our decision in Twigg, however, and Twigg is the case of Twigg v. Town of Kennebunkport, the Maine Supreme Court decided three years earlier in 1995, the law court states, with our decision in Twigg, however, we join the majority of jurisdictions that have altogether abandoned or modified that rule into non-existence. I think that clearly is the law, and clearly nothing more is needed to establish that this is not a self-created hardship. We believe we have presented this board with sufficient evidence, tremendous amount of evidence, in fact, for it to find that all of the statutory and criteria and ordinance criteria are met in this case for this board to grant a 7-foot practical difficulty variance from the 25-foot setback applicable to the Page property with respect to Beacon Lane, and we urge the board to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tracer. Any questions for Mr. Traister on his rebuttal?
You related a court case. Could you repeat the case itself, please?
The case I just cited from?
Yes.
Yes, that is the case of Rochelle, R-O-C-H-E-L-E-A-U, the town of Green, and that's the citation for that is 708 A-2nd 660, May 1998. I would also note that if this board reviewed the town attorney's opinion letter from a year ago, I believe the town attorney opined that Murray, Plummer, Murray, my firm, in the form of me, accurately cited this case for the proposition that buying property that needs a variance is not tantamount to a self-created hardship.
Other questions for Mr. Traister?
To my satisfaction, you did not address the notion of significant economic injury with respect to the comparable properties. Now, as I understand, and as I interpreting this ordinance, you look at the neighborhood and say this one person has a problem that everybody else in the neighborhood, say, has a garage or has an entryway, an overhang, a deck, whatever. And this person, because of changes in the setbacks laws, cannot build this whatever. So the purpose of it was to allow a person with a non-conforming lot or with a restriction to build up to what existed in the neighborhood. Now, the Lakes have, and their attorney have shown us pictures of houses that are significantly smaller than the one proposed. You're saying that significant economic injury will exist unless they can build this addition. And if I read the ordinance literally, and it is placing the definition significant economic injury, placing the applicant for a variance at a disadvantage in a neighborhood by applying zoning ordinance standards which would prevent the applicant from having a structure or accessory structure comparable in size, location, and number to those of the other lot owners in the immediate neighborhood, but in no cases fewer than 10 property owners. It seems to me Soloria has demonstrated that the request is in excess of what's in the comparable neighborhood among the 10 nearest property owners. So I'd like you to address that.
Well, I disagree with that. As I've stated, the comparables, quote-unquote comparables, that the Lakemans have chosen are not the closest houses. They are up on Two Lights Terrace.
Okay, I drove the neighborhood, and I looked at, that's why I asked you about that lot with the house that was 744 square feet in its footprint, and the gentleman said he expanded it by 432, so that's 1,100. So that, to me, is one of the nearer houses, and there are a couple of others. So it strikes me that this is a hurdle, that you have to demonstrate that if this one house is one of the nearest houses, is 1,132 square feet, why the pages 2,100 square feet or entitled to 2,100 square feet?
Well, again, I guess I need to step back and at least state on the record that we're at a disadvantage having not received the information that's been submitted to the board. So I'm listening to it, hearing these numbers thrown around without the opportunity to review the information. By contrast, we provide all of our information prior to today. But regardless,
that was the picture that Mrs. Page submitted.
I apologize.
Can I address what you said?
Mrs. Page, would like to address the board.
Mary Page, I will address what you said about the existing houses, no less than 10 in the area. I had walked up and down Beacon Lane, walked, minded you. There are 16 houses on that road. The one across the road from us on Two Lights, the Welches who are also on Two Lights Road, that is our neighborhood. We walk down Two Lights Road, we have to go 2.5 blocks to hit a house because all the houses are up on the hill. And so all those big houses are sitting up on the hill, and then once you get down farther, then you get closer towards the lobster shack, you get smaller rentals, you get summer homes, and so on. The ones we had submitted, these are in our neighborhood. The ones Mr. Lorry had submitted are two blocks from our house. We walk two blocks down there. So I hope that answers your question.
Well, isn't that 744 square foot house, the third house down on Beacon Lane from your house?
On the left, yes it is.
Okay, and that's...
And that's one house out of 16 that is comparable in size to ours. Comparable.
So you acknowledge that not all 10 of the nearest houses are significantly larger? Or, well...
Okay. Okay.
You have a question for Mr. Tracer?
Oh, I think I want to make a statement. It's quarter past 10. We've given these people three hours plus, been extremely generous with the time. And I know Mr. Lowry wants to respond, and I'm concerned about the hour, and I'm concerned about the issues. And the issues are what houses around there are, how many square feet. It was suggested earlier that if this is going to be an issue, a hurdle, as Bob just stated, then maybe we want to table this and drive out there in the neighborhood one more time and do a site walk, identify the houses with the square footage or whatever. I'm prepared to stay here longer this evening, but it appears to be an issue and a sensitive subject to both parties. And I just throw that out for comment. But I know that we're going to be going well beyond 10:30 with Mr. Lowry's comments and then a discussion. So it's going to be closer to 11 o'clock before we make a decision. And are we capable of making a decision since we got here at 6:30 this evening to start our agenda? Again, it was just a suggestion, a comment.
Well, a couple things. First of all, I was not inclined to have Mr. Lorry speak to us again. The comments from Mr. Tracer were in rebuttal to the comments of Mr. Lorry. I don't think Mr. Tracer has raised any new issues. I think they've all been in response. And if we give Mr. Lorry an opportunity to respond to what Mr. Tracer was responding to, we're going to hear from Mr. Tracer again. If, Mr. Lorry, you can identify a new issue that was raised that was not in response to your presentation, and you would like to address that one or those issues only, we can permit you to do that. But I don't think it's appropriate to have you respond to issues that you've already addressed. But before we even get to that, on the issue of tabling, I think I need to know what the sentiment of the board is as to whether people really think it's necessary to have further information on the neighborhood, square footage, setbacks. I mean, it seems to me that short of somebody hiring somebody or at least taking a tape measure out there, we're not going to get a lot of additional information. I've been through the neighborhood. I've done a site visit. I drove up and down the street a couple of times. I assume that that's true of the other board members also.
I almost sideswiped the lighthouse out there.
But that certainly is an option for the board for tonight. And if the sentiment of the board is that this should be tabled for further information that's needed to make an informed decision, then a motion to table is appropriate.
Mr. Chair, I think in the interest of moving things along as well, I agree with your earlier statement about procedural preventing Mr. Lowry, is it Lowry? Lowry, from an opportunity to rebut. To use the employer phrase he used earlier, he doesn't get a chance to second bite the apple. And I think you were correct about
his opportunity for the rebuttal, and that should limit that end of it, and we perhaps would begin a discussion about it.
I'd like to get into a discussion before we talk about
okay. Getting it all. In that case, Mr. Lurie, if you can identify an issue that you believe Mr. Traister raised for the first time in his rebuttal, we'll consider letting you respond to that. Is there something that you believe he raised for the first time that was not in rebuttal to your presentation?
Well, that's a tough one.
Well, I hate to say this, but
okay, there. I think there
is there or isn't there.
Well, I'll limit myself strictly to that, and we didn't choose Two Lights Terrace as the location that we thought was comparable. Okay, I wanted to explain that to the board. We didn't choose that. They had a property which was identified as being on Two Lights Terrace. That's why I pulled those four. We don't think that those are necessarily in the neighborhood and necessarily comparable, okay? But those are, we just put them in for what they're worth because they called something on that. They didn't go down Two Lights Road either in the other direction, if you look at the.
We heard that, we know.
All right.
Anything else that he raised that you thought he sprung on you for the first time, not having heard before?
Well, I just won't tell you he's wrong about a couple of things.
No, don't tell us that. We know you think he's wrong. Thank you for being brief. I see nobody else in the hearing room to speak for or against who hasn't already, so seeing no others, the public hearing portion of the hearing is closed, and we are now at the point that we will entertain discussion from board members.
I guess I'll make a general comment, and I was on the board last year when this property came before us, and I would like to compliment both the builder and the owner for taking a property that was an eyesore and turning it into a very, very attractive property. My personal opinion is it's a small house. I disagree with Mr. Lurie's characterization of it becoming a large house at 2,100 square feet. I don't consider that to be a large house. I don't consider the expansion of a permitted use to be against the practical difficulty definition. I disagree with Mr. Lurie's assertion that 10 of the nearest property owners under the significant economic injury should be the 10 nearest property owners. I think the property as it stands right now has been a great improvement to the neighborhood. I think a small addition to it will do no injury to the neighborhood and in fact will enhance the overall neighborhood.
I think I agree with everything Jack says, except I'm not sure this is a small addition. And I'm not convinced that I've looked at the neighborhood and I sat there for a while and I looked at the comparable houses. And again, I'm reading the ordinance as bringing a property up to the level of the surrounding neighborhood. And of course, this is a very heterogeneous neighborhood with rather expansive houses on it and some relatively small houses. If I take 10 of the nearest, and I think a project of this size is significantly larger than 10 of the nearest, and hence an expansion of this dimension is more than is justified under the ordinance. I think they're entitled to an expansion, maybe a single story, but I think that if the intention of the ordinance is to allow somebody to bring their property up to what's customary in the neighborhood, what the other houses in the neighborhood are like, then this constitutes a much more grandiose expansion.
Uh, Now, Bob, you read that comparable in size more strictly than I do. And I read that as saying we need to look at the 10 closest properties, and we need to have, if we're going to permit a variance to build an addition, the addition has to at least be in keeping with, I guess, the general tenor of the 10 closest, but not necessarily bigger than the smallest of those 10, but just in keeping with the general ambiance, I guess. Of
and that's part of the problem. I don't think there is a general ambiance in this neighborhood.
But I'm hung up more on the undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood with what appears to be a fairly strict requirement that we not build, that the addition not be closer than the average of the nearest 10 principal structures. The undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood definition is interestingly written different than the significant economic injury definition that refers to in no case fewer than 10 of the nearest property owners. But the undesirable change says the average of the nearest 10 principal structures. And I don't, the way I'm reading that, I don't think the applicants have overcome that hurdle.
I guess my feeling about that, and you make a good point, I thought about it for a long time and read it, thought about it sitting here, was that the intent of that, I think, is to prevent or preclude an addition or a new construction, let's say an addition, increase or, that's the right one I'm looking for here, going beyond the setback requirements further than the average of the nearest 10 principal structures. I think the present case where the addition does not change the nonconformity, my interpretation of it is that that doesn't really play into this at all. Since the current structure is already 5 or 6 feet from the road, the addition is going to be no closer than 18 feet, I believe it was. So it doesn't really increase the nonconformity. And so I don't think in my interpretation that it plays into the intent of that particular definition.
If what you're saying is that if the present structure was 25 feet and they wanted a variance down to 15 feet.
Right. That would play.
That's pulling it closer.
Yeah, right. Right, but this doesn't fall any closer, so it doesn't. It's just my opinion that it doesn't play into what I believe they intended with that language.
What about the larger provision, which says the structure is larger? Well, it probably isn't larger than the average of the 10.
Yeah, my feeling, I've driven the street a number of times, almost bumped into a lighthouse once, as I said. I was looking at the other houses and veered off. I didn't really feel that the addition would make the house any larger than the average.
I drew a similar conclusion.
Other comments?
I'm having a hard time wrestling with this economic injury. They've proved that they can live in the existing house. It doesn't meet their needs, but there is some benefits there. They've identified houses in the neighborhood that are smaller than this. The lot is an odd lot. It's a unique lot. And that's probably why the house is small. That's why it has been small. That's probably why it remains small. Other houses in the neighborhood are on a much larger lot. And that's where I have a hard time justifying giving someone permission to expand a house just because houses in the neighborhood are larger, even though they're on larger lots. I can understand the situation and the concern and the need for a larger home, but I think the lot is limiting what you can do with this structure. And although, if you read the six criteria, maybe all six could be satisfied in a vote, you know, on an individual case. But overall, I'm still having a hard time justifying voting for the practical difficulty.
I might comment a little bit. I did talk to Mike Hill about the property, the unique circumstance of the property in relation to the economic injury. Was there a contradiction there? And basically what he told me was that the need for the unique circumstances of the property and under A was the property, and whereas the economic injury was to the structure on the property. So if you met the unique circumstances of the property because it was narrow in this particular case, then that would be to the property and the other one would be to the structure. Did I explain that at all? Are you confused?
Oh, I've been confused since 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
Bruce, can you go over it again?
Well, I thought maybe there was a contradiction between the need for variance due to the unique circumstances of property and a significant economic injury. Mm-hmm. And his comments were that one has got to do with the property itself, and the economic injury has got to do with the structure on the property. So you could have a unique property. The need for the variance was due to the uniqueness of the property, but the structure would have to meet the significant economic injury standard. So the two are separated in that respect. I don't know if that helps at all.
No, that makes sense.
It does. Because I thought it was a direct contradiction, but he explained to me that it really isn't.
And who are you speaking to?
Mike Hill.
Further discussion by the board? Hearing no other comments, are we ready to go through the various elements? With a show of hands,
could we have the record show, you know, which way the determinations are going on these?
The record will reflect that, yes, at least by a numerical vote. Why don't you follow us through? By a show of hands, how many board members believe, starting at the top of the ordinance, that the relief sought by the application would result in no substantial departure from the intent of the ordinance? Does everybody understand that?
Should you repeat that?
Well, the very first element of the ordinance, it says that we are empowered to grant variances from the terms of this ordinance, provided that, small Roman one, there is no substantial departure from the intent of the ordinance. So that's one of the required elements that we find that the relief requested in the application will not result in a substantial departure from the intent of the ordinance. So, a show of hands as to how many believe that the application will not result in a substantial departure from the intent of the ordinance. Okay, that has been satisfied by a vote of 6-0.
Is that a finding or a conclusion?
That is a finding.
Okay.
By a show of hands, how many board members find that a literal enforcement of the ordinance would cause a practical difficulty as defined by 30A MRSA section 4353-4C. That has been found in the affirmative by a vote of 5 in favor, 1 opposed. Or I didn't even ask, are you opposing or abstaining? Opposed. Then going through elements A through F in the ordinance, by a show of hands, how many board members find that the need for a variance is due to the unique circumstances of the property and not to the general conditions of the neighborhood? That is found in the affirmative by a vote of 6-0. By a show of hands, how many board members find that the granting of a variance will not produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood and will not unreasonably detrimentally affect the use or market value of abutting properties? Opposed? Abstain? Mr. Frustasi?
I'm still reading it. No, I'll go in the affirmative with that one.
With the affirmative?
Yes.
Then that is found in the affirmative by a vote of 4-2. By a show of hands, how many board members find that the practical difficulty is not the result of action taken by the applicant or a prior owner? Opposed? That's found in the affirmative by a vote of 4-2. By a show of hands, how many board members find that that there is no other feasible alternative that no other feasible alternative to a variance is available to the petitioner? Opposed? Abstain?
Again, we're still getting used to this. That I can't vote for it, and I'm afraid to vote against it.
Well, abstaining is an option.
It is an option, but you know, there still should be clarification on that. And that's what I said earlier, that you can vote for all of these and still feel as though it's you don't want to give the variance or the practical difficulty. So I'll abstain from that one.
Okay, so again, in favor of that, we had 4 in favor, 1 opposed, 1 abstention. By a show of hands, how many board members find that the granting of a variance will not unreasonably adversely affect the natural environment? That's found in the affirmative by a vote of 6-0. And by a show of hands, the number of board members who find that the property is not located in whole or in part within shoreland areas is described in Title 38, Section 435. And that is found in the affirmative by a vote of 6-0. Now, taking the application as a whole, can I have a motion from anyone?
I would move that we approve the application of Ronald and Mary Page for a variance from the strict application of zoning ordinance requirements of Section 19.6-1. For a front property line variance of 7 feet from the required 25 feet to construct a 16-foot by 25-foot two-story addition the existing dwelling at 18 feet from that property line.
Do I have a second?
I'll second it to put it on the table.
All those in favor of the motion? Two in favor, opposed? Four opposed, the motion fails.
Mr. Chairman.
By a vote of two.
I'm going to have to immediately request reconsideration. The board has just approved each and every element of these ordinances criteria. It is bound to approve the application.
Well, first of all, the board did not approve each of them. By a vote on each individual element, or by a showing, the board members were indicating how they were inclined to vote, whether each of those measures were met or not.
Didn't the board just take a formal vote on whether each of the ordinance's criteria were met? And if so, if every one of those criteria are met, including the first two factors before the six conditions, I think the board is bound to approve the application.
I take exception, Mr. Chairman. I can find
I don't think that's
find it fails right. on different grounds, but it fails.
That's right. Different board members voted, found that different elements failed.
But each element was approved as met.
Well, each element wasn't individually passed as such. There wasn't a motion on the table for any of those. That was simply for each of the board members to indicate whether they felt each of those factors had been met. But we were not voting on a motion. I was simply asking each of the board members at that stage to indicate whether they felt that there had been a showing, whether each board member was able to find that each of those factors had been met.
Perhaps, maybe I needed clarification. Has the board voted, as I believe it's required to do, as to whether each of the criteria is met?
The board has voted on one motion, and that motion was on the application as a whole, and the application was just denied.
And so the board does not intend to make any findings as to whether the application meets the ordinance's criteria?
Well, each of the board members has voted on whether each member believes that each of the findings has been satisfied. Or whether each of the elements have been satisfied.
Can I just in for a second? Mr. Tracer is entitled to a written decision with findings of fact, which you can adopt at your next meeting, whatever. That's what he's entitled to. He's not entitled to reconsideration. He should have, prepare the written decision and then we'll go from there.
I think I've explained it, Mr. Tracer, as well as I can. I mean, you've just seen the way the board voted. You heard the motion as presented and saw the board vote on the motion.
The criteria had been met. I think it's bound to approve the application. How can each and every criteria be voted on to have been approved by the board as complied with, yet the application be entitled or be denied?
Because different board members are voting against the motion as a whole for different reasons.
The Supreme Court does that all the time.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I think I prefaced the vote by saying that this may happen, that we might vote all of these six items in the affirmative and still vote not to give the variance. And I agree with the applicant's attorney, that it's awkward for us to vote for all of these six in the affirmative and still deny it. And he is entitled to the finding of facts. And I can't see anything that we've written, prepared, that's going to justify this board rejecting this application. I mean, it's a problem with the ordinance, the way I see it. And I think it should be corrected. I voted against it. There's reasons. I felt that some of the facts brought tonight were compelling for me to vote against it. if it will satisfy the applicant, then I would like to reconsider one of these conclusions. And that's the granting of the variance will not produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood and will not unnecessarily detrimentally affect the use of the market value of abutting owners. I vote in the affirmative. If I may change my vote to the negative, that might be enough to substantiate our vote tonight. But I think that we should revisit this with the attorney to see how we can correct it so this doesn't happen again.
I don't perceive the need for that at all. The Supreme Court, when they, if they, there are seven justices, they might reject an appeal, but three of them might reject it on one ground and but think that that there are two, that another ground is totally competent, while four might think exactly the opposite. What's relevant is not that the reasons five people might think that any given argument is competent, but as a whole might reject it because they reject different things. That happens all the time. I don't see that as an impediment.
Well, as a matter of procedure, under Robert's Rules of Order, is Joe within his rights, having voted in the affirmative, to now request reconsideration? I mean, I think only somebody having voted in the affirmative can request reconsideration. So I think he's within his right to ask that we reconsider that element. And I'd entertain that motion.
May I ask what the motion, you want a motion to reconsider?
He's asking for a motion to reconsider the findings on the element as to whether the granting of the variance will produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood or will unreasonably detrimentally affect the use or market value of abutting properties.
Now that was voted unanimous. What would the change of one
no,
vote
No, it was 4-2. Vote was 4-2.
That was a 4-2 vote.
I voted against that. I didn't say that was satisfied.
Which one are you?
Item number 2.
Do we have a second on Joe's motion to reconsider that element?
Second.
All those in, do we need a motion? Do we need a vote on the motion to reconsider with a second? All those in favor of reconsidering? The motion fails, it's not going to be reconsidered.
Okay.
Then the vote stands as is. And that concludes our hearing this evening on this application. Thank you all for coming. Wait, we're not done?
Can I just make a comment on the no feasible alternative variance, no feasible alternative variance available to a petitioner. As I interpret that.
Is this general or is this specific?
This is general.
Okay.
I was talking about the interpretation of the ordinance. You said you didn't know what it meant. I'm interpreting it as you're entitled to put 20%, occupy 20% of a lot. And if you can't do that, then without a variance, then there's no other reasonable alternative. That's the way I interpret that. So if there's another, if you want to occupy 20% of a lot, in this case 2,600 square feet, and you couldn't do it without a variance, that would satisfy you. That's the way I interpret it.
The only other item on the agenda is communications, and the only item listed is a discussion of a cover letter that accompany applications. I would suggest that in light of the hour, that we defer discussion of that to next month.
Agreed. We've been deferring for 5 or 6 months now, or 4 months anyways. I mean, I appreciate the lateness of the hour, but I keep copying it, putting it in the packet, and keep getting deferred.
So put it on the
maybe
first?
Maybe you could all take that home,
why don't
look
we,
at it, and comment it at the next meeting.
Is it appropriate to take that up as old business at the next meeting?
Sure, because it will be old business.
And take it up as the first item on the agenda next month?
Okay.
Can you list that on our agenda for next month as old business?
I shall. Thank you.
And that way we'll be sure to get to it first.
Thank you.
Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Right here.
The meeting is adjourned.
What? Jack. Yeah.
There's an extra fact. It's got to.
It's the thing we had one item on the agenda.
That wording right here.
Mm-hmm.